The Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino, home away from home for Golden Boy Boxing. That you see, the pool is only about 115 today. How many people out there? We're at the Special Event Center because inside the heat is going to keep going. John Leon, Colombia, making his pro debut. Perro Grande, Marco Magdaleno from the Magdaleno Brothers is on the card, as is Art Zatkovanisi. That's next on Ring TV Live. Palm trees are swaying in India, a bit of a breeze, barely, but we're going to go inside and you're going to see some fighters coming your way. Doors just opened up, crowd coming in to get away from that heat as they get ready for six exciting fights coming your way on Ring TV Live. Alongside my partners, Doug Fisher and Steve Kim, I'm Bethel Duran. Thank you for joining us tonight. Doug, of course, the editor of ringtv.com, and Steve, one of the best boxing scribes out there, breaking the news and notes down. And we're going to have plenty of news and notes this weekend from UCN Live and Boxing Scene, the one and only Steve Kim. And right now, we have three fights coming your way, and there you see him making his pro debut. Desde Bogota, Colombia, Jan Leon, 22 years old. He's been in the United States for 5 months, living and training in Los Angeles. He will be taking on Jose Huerta, a couple of fighters that are just eager to get into the ring. And we have six fights coming your way, Doug, and it's always good to be back in the desert where it just feels like there's a good vibe every time we come here.
Well, we always get good action. There's always fights. Even the fights that are kind of under the radar out there in the U.S. boxing scene, they always deliver once they step into that ring here at Fantasy Springs.
And make sure you send us your tweet. Use the hashtag RingTVLive. You know, they're going to be flying around here all night long. Ring announcer Joe Martinez is in, ready to go.
Well, fine fans, a very good evening and welcome to Fantasy Springs Resort Casino here in Indio, California, for exciting night of professional boxing, all brought to you tonight by Oscar De La Hoya's Golden Boy Promotions and sponsored by Cerveza Tecate Born Ball. We are set with our first bout this evening, four rounds, this in the welterweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing white trunks, trimmed in yellow, he weighed officially 144 and 1/2 pounds. Tonight he enters the ring for the second time after a draw in his professional debut. From Villa Hermosa, Mexico, here is Jose Huerta. And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wears white trunks trimmed in red. He weighed officially 146 and 1/4 pounds. Tonight, he makes his professional debut and joins us from Bogota, Colombia. Here is John El Colombian Leon. And the referee in charge of the action is David Mendoza.
Caballero. Caballero.
Referee David Mendoza with the instructions. Four rounds in their welterweight division. Here's the tail of the tape, Doug.
Man, Huerta's got his work cut out for him tonight. Leon, 20 years younger at age 22. He is 6 inches taller and has a significant reach advantage.
That's right, Jose Huerta from Villa Hermosa, Tabasco, Mexico, 42 years old. He said he's always been in the gym, using boxing as his primary way of staying in conditioning. Does triathlons, he's a runner, he's also a businessman. So he finally said, you know what, I don't feel my age, I feel good, let me decide to get in there. He has one pro fight, it was a draw. That was the only one, that was in April 25th, they went the distance four rounds. John Leon, desde Bogota, Colombia. He's 160 amateur fights. He was part of the Colombian national team. There was aspirations of possibly going to Rio this year for the Olympics. He was qualifying at the bigger tournaments, working his way there, trying to represent the country. lost a major tournament, and when you lose those tournaments, you can still qualify at a different one.
Right.
You said, why do that? Opportunity came for him to come to the United States and make some money. And that's what he's doing right now, making his pro debut, living by himself in Whittier, California. He is a staple made of Pablo Rubio Jr., who we've seen on Ring TV Live, and also the Colombian that got him to the United States, Oscar Negrete, the Golden Boy fighter. Said, put him in touch with his manager. Said, why are you fighting as an amateur with no headgear, risking those headbutts, the cuts? Come to the United States, make some money, and that's what he's doing.
I get paid for swapping leather. And I tell you what, Leon has the look of a professional fighter, does not have that amateur style. He definitely seems like one of these tall, rangy guys that carries a lot of power in his shots.
Not bad, Steve. When you show up, first pro fight, and you got some sponsors on your trunks right
no,
away.
No, he does. It's a little bit of a NASCAR look. Then there's a good left hook to the body by Leon. One thing that's very apparent, though, he's going to have to learn how to punch with his body a little bit more. He has a good whipping left hook there. Certainly has good natural size, but he seems to be at this stage, and again, very early, only 22 years old, guys, still a bit of an arm puncher.
Huerta's covering up. He's in some pain, some body shots, and I think he's trying to say that it's done. Is he telling the referee, Dave Mendoza? Mendoza asking if he still want to go?
No, he's done.
And he said, no, he is calling it himself. 42 years old, said, you know what? I know what punishment. That's
yes,
called being smart in your advanced age. So John Freddy Sanchez Leon desde Bogota, Colombia. Felicidades. Le ganas. And his family at home, esposa Diana, padre Jose Elias, hijo Dominic. They watch their man, John Leon, win his pro debut in a first-round stoppage. As Huerta in his corner. Well, he wanted to be a pro. He just felt what it's like being a pro.
The fantasy is over. Right? And he wanted to give it a try, see what it's like to be in there and trade leather as a professional fighter. And we're going to see some highlights of what it was like for Huerta. It was not pleasant in there with a man young enough to be his son. He was taller, rangier, stronger. A lot heavier hitter. He's measuring him for right hands.
And that was
tapping to the body. Yeah, left to the body.
Yeah. The one thing I noticed about Leon early on is got a sweeping right hand. They're going to have to clean that up, shorten up that punch, make it more compact. He does have a pretty good whipping left hook. And you take a look at the body of Huerta, he kind of has that dad body. A dad that stopped working out about 5-10 years ago. So it's not a big surprise that a body shot would debilitate him.
And there you see Leon feeling pretty good. Leon is a lion. That would be, the Leos, but they're not in session right now. Happy birthday to everybody that's a Cancer right now celebrating their birthdays in the month of July. As the first round is done, Joe Martinez looks like he's ready in the ring. And if Joe wants to talk, go ahead, Joe. If you want to talk, go for it, baby. Yeah, why not? Go for it, Joe.
Ladies and gentlemen, in comes the official time, 2 minutes, 12 seconds, round number one. We have your winner in his pro debut by KO victory, John of Colombia, Leon!
Representing Shark Sports. So the stablemates, Pablo Rubio, feeling pretty good. Rubio actually in New York, sparring with Carl Frampton, and we're going to see him August 5th as he takes on Rafael Gramajo at the LA Fight Club in downtown LA at the Belasco. Get your tickets for that one coming up soon.
Yeah, I saw that tweet or that Instagram from Pablo, and that is excellent work.
Looking Margarito-esque with that hair, Pablo Rubio. I know, Steve, you love anything Margarito-related.
The Tijuana Tornado. Unfortunately, the storm is still brewing. August 13th takes on Canelo's brother in Rosarito.
And, Steve, while we have a chance right now, let's get into some quick news and notes because the next fight, because this one ended so damn fast, we're going to have to stall for a little. As we call it in TV, Phil. Steve, obviously, where do you want to go with this one? Pacquiao was all over your Twitter timeline this afternoon.
Well, I mean, Pokemon Go is back, and so is the Pac-Man. And I think Pokemon Go is a lot more popular 2016 than Manny Pacquiao. They are looking for a dance partner. Bob Arum told various members of the media they're coming back either October 29th or November 5th. Adrian Broner asked for about $6.2 million. He was offered $4 million. That fight went into Bolivian. And now Danny Garcia is the latest to turn down that same number. Now, I'm not going to be E.F. Hutton. I'm not going to tell fighters what to do. I'm not the one taking punches. It's their decision. It's their life. But I just want to put this into perspective, guys. When Manny Pacquiao was doing over 1 million pay-per-view buys every time out, guys like Margarito and Claude, they were receiving guarantees of $4 million. So just keep that in mind.
Well, also keep this in mind. Manny Pacquiao of 2016 is not that Manny Pacquiao of 2008, 2009, 2010 that was doing the million pay-per-view buys. Back then, he was dangerous.
He was actually a
fighter. If you're a young guy like Adrian Broner or Danny Garcia, isn't this a tremendous opportunity?
Yeah.
Shouldn't it just not be about money, but the opportunity of getting that scalp on your ledger to beat a bona fide first ballot Hall of Famer?
Doug, the issue is, it is about money, and these guys are being offered, at least on paper with the commission reports, twice as much as their career-high paydays at $4 million. I don't think either of these guys have ever busted the $2 million threshold. But again, the winning at times is not just about the payday. The winning is parlaying a big victory into bigger and better things. And I think at times you have to be able to see the trees through the forest. It reminds me of a story Jim Thomas told me, the attorney for Evander Holyfield. They were negotiating the fight back in 1996, and Evander Holyfield was insistent on being very hard-nosed about several issues. And Jim Thomas actually called a timeout, took Evander over, and he said, Evander, I want to ask you one question. Do you think you can beat Mike Tyson? And Evander got very angry. He said, what type of question is that? And Jim Thomas said, because you are negotiating your way out of the fight. If you think you can win, don't get yourself out of the fight. Get us into it, and we'll stick it to him in the rematch. The rest is history.
But to play devil's advocate here, if a guy is turning down $10 million, right, or he's demanding $10 million, he's asking for four, he's expecting four, why would you just completely cut off negotiations? Why not go and try to go somewhere in the middle?
Well, you're absolutely right. My understanding is with Broner, the $10 million offer was thrown out there. I was told by a good source it was about 6.2 only. And you know with Broner, he's got a lot of kids to feed, literally. With that said, we have to understand one thing. The Manny Pacquiao business of 2015 and 16 is not what it was in 2009, 10, 11, and 12. There was a time when Manny Pacquiao would do right around $1 million to $1.2 million average. So this is all math. The last Manny Pacquiao pay-per-view against Tim Bradley, April 9th, the third fight, I think did less than $300,000, according to the people I've talked to, industry
sources. How much did Manny make off that fight?
He gets a guarantee of $20 million.
He gets a guarantee. That's why they tank as a business.
Right,
yeah.
Right. And
he gets guaranteed 20.
Yeah, and Bob.
So if you're coming in, say you're Broner, say you're Danny Garcia, you're coming in and he's getting 20 and you're the bigger, you're the younger guy, you're the hungrier fighter, why not go and negotiate for that?
You know, the wise philosopher Confucius says all the time, do not count other people's money. At the end of the day, you are still the B-side. And my understanding is that Bob Arum and Top Rank lost in excess of $10 million on the last show. Now, nobody's going to throw a benefit for Bob Arum. He'll be okay. He will eat tomorrow very well.
And tonight.
But again, if you are a young, hungry guy in their prime, Doug, shouldn't you be chomping at the bit at the opportunity
to push this guy
off the cliff?
That's what I would think. You have an all-time great. You have an opportunity to share the ring with an all-time great, getting that spotlight, being a huge pay-per-view, but also to beat the all-time great, to beat a bona fide first ballot Hall of Famer. That goes on your resume. You take a step towards greatness yourself.
More of that discussion on the next round. You have two podcasts.
The Three Knockdown Rule and the Montoya Factor.
The Montoya Factor. So that Manny Pacquiao Factor will be coming in for you in those podcasts. Steve will break it down there. We'll be back for more from the Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino. Second fight of the night on a six-card bout from Indio, California.
I knew I could get myself out of this. I just needed some hope and some help.
I took the first step to recovery when I made the call.
If you're depressed, drinking, and using drugs, you may need help. And the Affordable Care Act guarantees coverage of substance abuse. Call the Addiction, Hope, and Helpline now for a free assessment.
I had problems just getting to sleep, drinking, and using pills every night.
I feel like I'm losing control. I'm afraid I'll lose my job or even my family.
Are you losing hope? You can recover and get back on track. Call now for hope and help with proven gentle recovery programs.
I never thought that I could be somebody who didn't drink and use drugs.
I have something to hold on to for strength. I'm in recovery, getting the help I need.
Call the Addiction, Hope, and Helpline now for a free assessment with someone who cares.
Call 800-437-7740, 800-437-7740.
Cinturones aquí se hacen a un lado. Hay que pelear por honor y por gloria nada más.
Liam's a talent. He'll fight anyone. We're going to make a big fight for him in the autumn. I think he's the biggest name in that division, and I will make sure it happens. And I believe by the end of the year, he will be the best.
shots landed by Orozco.
28-year-old. And Acosta just taking a deep breath.
Dropped with the left by Orozco. And it is over. A first round stoppage for Antonio. Relentless Orozco.
Jojo Diaz Jr.
July 30th here in Indio. Get your tickets. Antonio Orozco, the main event. He's undefeated. The co-feature, Joseph Jojo Diaz, will be on that card. Undefeated prospect coming his way. He's graduated from being on Ring TV. He's now close to being a pay-per-view fighter. And that fight on July 30th, Joseph Diaz Jr. will be putting on a show. He's actually the fourth member of our crew. We're going to hear him throughout the night with his analysis about the boxing game. But right now, Jojo, how is camp coming along as you get ready for the 30th?
You know what? Camp's coming along very well. I mean, I have 2 weeks left, so all the hard work's already done. Now it's just time to focus on getting my weight down and staying hydrated until the weigh-ins. But other than that, man, I've been well prepared, and I'm ready to give everybody another great show on HBO Latino.
2012 Olympian from South Omani, Joseph Jojo Diaz. You'll be hearing more from him throughout the night. Making his way into the ring right now is our second bout of the night. Hugo Partida is walking in. He's already in the ring right above us. And right now is Marco Magdaleno climbing through the ropes. That's Hugo Partida from Aguascalientes, Mexico. He is 3-6. A veteran fighter, he's 37 years old. Second fight in the United States. And there you see him, Marco Magdaleno, younger brother of Jesse and Diego. There you see his trainer, Antonio Diaz. Joel Diaz also in that corner. And let's go, our ring announcer, Joe Martinez.
Well, fight fans, we are set to go with our next bout tonight. Four rounds, this in the lightweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. Wearing black trunks trimmed in blue, he weighed officially 133.5 pounds. He enters the ring tonight for the 10th time as a professional, hailing from Aguascalientes, Mexico. Here is Hugo Padilla. And across the ring stands his opponent, fighting out of the red corner. Wearing black, trimmed in gold, he weighed in 134 pounds even. As a young professional, he stands perfect in the ring tonight in three bouts, three victories, including two wins coming by way of knockout. Fighting out of Indio, California, here is the undefeated Perro Grande, Marco Magdaleno. And your referee in charge of the action is Zachary Young.
Your shorts okay, nothing left to say, but good luck, all right?
Referee Zach Young with the instructions to tell of the tape, Doug Fisher, for these two fighters in the lightweight division.
Magdaleno is 17 years younger at age 23. He is 1 inch taller, and their reach is equal.
Marco Magdaleno from Las Vegas, now training in India, the Coachella Valley with the Diaz brothers. He walked in the ring with a shirt that says, "Fighting solves everything." His brother Diego met a kid named Hayden Perry in Las Vegas, who was 11 years old, battling cancer. And those shirts are for sale with all the proceeds going to Hayden and the fight for cancer. Hayden, you're in Las Vegas. We know you're watching and you're fighting. We're right there with you. Marco Magdaleno in the black gold trunks, the southpaw. He's 23 years old, 3-0, two KOs. He's a fighter, comes from a fighting family, his brother Jesse and Diego. And Marco, the youngest one, all of his fights have been in Southern California, all here at the Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino. Two KOs. His most recent fight was in March when he stopped Luis Silva in the third round. His opponent, Hugo Alberto Emmanuel Padilla from Aguascalientes, Mexico, where Doug once called the fight. Central part of the state.
Beautiful area.
Beto, you mentioned the Magdaleno brothers, Diego and Jesse, who actually at one time all trained under Joel Diaz. Recently, Joel Diaz jettisoned Jesse from the gym. And I asked him earlier, has that caused a rift or been awkward for Marco, and he said, no, it's actually made Marco a little bit happier, more focused. You can read into that what you will.
That's interesting. He's actually looking a little more polished than I've seen him in his previous three bouts. And all three have taken place right here at Fantasy Springs Casino, so we are very familiar with Marco. But he was known as the Magdaleno brother, who wasn't the amateur standout like Diego and Jesse. Wasn't as polished as his brothers. And he made up for it with aggression. He was a crowd-pleasing fighter. But there's a fine line between youthful enthusiasm and being reckless. And obviously, as he progresses, he has to make sure not to cross that line. And I'm sure that's something that Joel Diaz has been working with him.
Magdaleno saying that the difference with him in the last fight is that he's now feeling calm in the ring. That Joel Diaz tells him over and over, calm your blank down.
Yeah.
In the gym, in the ring, overall, that he just needs to be a patient fighter because he has the ability. But that's what we see in a lot of these young kids when they come into the ring. They're no longer amateurs. They just go at it because that amateur style, you only have 2 minutes.
Well, Beto, there's that old saying from John Wooden, be quick but don't be in a hurry. I still remember a couple of years ago a very good young featherweight by the name of Oscar Valdez who will be fighting next week for his first world title. I remember his first 5, 6 to 10 fights. He was shot out of a rocket ship and in many respects did not know how to pace himself. And if you look at him now, even a guy like him, who was the two-time Olympian, had to develop a professional pace.
Mention that shirt that Magdaleno was wearing when he walked into the ring. Help out his young man, Hayden Perry. Hayden needs your help. Fighting solves everything. Imako is something that the Magdaleno brothers have. Say, I am a knockout, which means you can believe in anything. If you believe in it, you can go and beat it up and get that. And Fighting solves everything because they want Hayden to fight. And here's that Instagram post on El Perro Grande. And you can buy those shirts. Go check it out, and the proceeds will help out Hayden and his family.
Right lands to the chest of Padilla. Magdaleno staying on top of his older opponent. Just grazing him with the 1-2 combination, coming back with the right hook to the hip.
Marco Magdaleno, the southpaw, Clark High School graduate in Las Vegas. Now calling India home. And one thing that Joel Diaz has for his younger fighters, Joseph Diamante Aguirre, who we saw recently, he's gonna fight in Cancun next weekend. He's actually in the corner, the main sparring partner for Magdaleno, said that they live in a house owned by Joel Diaz, much like a fraternity house, minus the fraternity antics. They wake up at 5:30. Everybody that lives in that house, they go and they run the sand dunes. They train together. Everybody's up early working out together. They're a boxing team.
Yeah.
That's the way they treat it here in Indio, California.
And Beto, Joel Diaz is a no-nonsense trainer. He really is not a player's coach. And I believe that was one of the issues with Jesse Magdaleno. Quite frankly, he was not fitting in. He was not complying with some of the other team members and the wishes of that man, Joel Diaz. Magdaleno now is being trained by Manuel Robles, and he is in line eventually,
He's supposed to be trained by Manuel Robles. Right. Magdaleno has gone to the gym once.
Yeah, hasn't shown up yet, and he is the WBO 122-pound contender for Nonito Donaire, but we do note he's never actually made that weight.
That's true. That's a debate that we have on the Ring Magazine's rating committee, whether or not to rank this guy at junior featherweight. Everyone says he's a junior featherweight, but he's always weighing like 125, 126.
Not weighing that right now because he is nowhere near fighting shape. But his brother is El Perro Grande, the big dog. The reason he has that nickname, Joel Diaz said when he was an amateur, he'd come into the gym with his chest puffed out, shoulders back, kind of like a German Shepherd at attention. He's like, who's this kid? He's only like 5'5", standing like he's 6'5".
Right.
The big dog. And he's like, that's what he is. El Perro Grande, the name has stuck with him. He's here in the second round against 37-year-old Hugo Padilla.
Nice. He backs up his bark, though, particularly with body shots. He's really chopping Padilla down to the hips and the ribcage.
50 seconds to go in the second round, scheduled for four. Three years he's been with Joel Diaz as an amateur, doing a lot of the amateur competitions, the desert showdowns that they have here in the Coachella. He's actually in this building and around him. And Magdalena was the younger brother who was, his older brother told him, don't even box. Why? Go to school. Do something. Use your head instead of your hands. Of course, the younger brothers are not going to listen.
No.
And he's now in the fight game. He hurt Padilla's body with that shot with the right hand. Upstairs, good 1-2, uppercut. Wow, swing and a miss from Padilla. More body work from Padilla. I mean, from Magdaleno against the body of Padilla. Final seconds of the second, scheduled for four. Ring TV live cameras were there with Marco Magdaleno.
I look at my brothers, they're both amazing fighters. They both have different set of skills that I pick from each and from, you know, both of them. My brother Diego, fantastic, fantastic boxer. My brother Jesse, he's a really quick speed, you know, type of fighter. Great boxer as well. And I pick up both a little bit from both from them, and I put it, you know, into my style of fighting, and then I use everything that I have. Seeing my brothers where they've been and the places they go and everything, all of that motivates me, and it makes me even more hungrier. And it's not a competition between me and my brothers, but it pushes me beyond the limits because I want to be just as great or try to be better than them.
Getting ready for the third down. Oh, football season around the corner.
Training camp is a couple of weeks away, Beto.
Oh, there's a team in LA and there's almost a pro team in Miami with the Hurricanes.
Got to get that stadium fixed. One thing it's interesting about Magdaleno talking about physical condition, I'll be honest with you guys, at 134, you look at the stomach and the abdominal area of Magdaleno, very fleshy tonight, Doug.
Yeah, there's a little bit of flab there. It just could be how his physique is, but it might let us know that maybe he can make 130 pounds. And he would be a very big junior lightweight.
Magdaleno with 8 pro rounds coming into this fight. His opponent Padilla had 46 coming into this one. El Aguerrido is Padilla's nickname, the aggressive one. Start showing some of that as Magdaleno is controlling this fight.
Yeah, he's not aggressive against Magdaleno. Magdaleno definitely the aggressor, but what Padilla is durable. I think he's only been stopped once, and that was in the 6th round. So he was chosen by Golden Boy's matchmaker, Robert Diaz, for a reason, and that is to take Magdaleno rounds.
You're correct, Doug. His only time he was stopped in January in the 6th round. That was a technical decision. Padilla from Aguascalientes, Mexico, is un panadero. He's a bread man. He drives a delivery truck for Bimbo, you know, the bread.
Oh, yeah.
So that's what he does in the morning. 6 a.m. he's at work. Afterwards, he goes to work in the gym, doing his road work, sparring, trying to get some sessions in. So just another way to supplement the income. He's durable.
He's trying, too. He doesn't have the physical strength or the power to really get Magdaleno's attention, much less respect.
He fought in April in Ontario. This is the second time he's been to the United States. Parker Magdaleno trying to open up some eyes. Doesn't have a promoter. He's trying to catch the attention of somebody assign him. Not matching him up easy. They're going up against guys that are men. Magdaleno is a southpaw. Started boxing at the age of 10, didn't really start taking it too serious until he was a teenager. In the gym, you're gonna like this one, Steve. In Spanish is a word for sparring, but when you really go at it, it's a bad word, so I can't really say it. But it ends with os. And he said, you know, there's plenty of the, like a butt whipping to say. He said, there's plenty of butt whippings in that gym because that sparring is so good with the people that that Joel Diaz has there. With it used to be Victor Ortiz was in there. You have Magdaleno, you have Aguirre. And he said afterwards, we serve it on a plate to take some home with you because there's plenty of butt whoopings for everybody in that gym. That's how it is in the Diaz gym in Coachella.
Magdaleno's getting an earful right now from his corner, but
what do you think he wants him to do?
He's winning these rounds. They want him to overwhelm this guy. They look at Padilla and they say, this guy is no threat. You need to impose yourself. Walk him down. Break him down.
Yeah, and that was the Diaz brothers in stereo. Okay, the Wi-Fi was coming in very good. And specifically, they wanted him to go back down to the body like he did in rounds one and two. The body will not move. The head does it. Padilla's actually pretty elusive in his own awkward way up top.
Padilla in the black with the blue. Magdaleno is a southpaw. Marco Antonio Magdaleno, 3-0 with two KOs. And at the end of the third round, I'll talk about how there's plenty of butt whoopings handed out that gym. There's an earful. My goodness. And that's what you expect from Joel Diaz because he expects perfection from these guys.
Well, it's not just Joel Diaz. It's Antonio Diaz, who was a hell of a junior welterweight contender. I don't know, like 15, almost 20 years ago. And I tell you what, they talk about the butt whippings in the gym when the Diaz brothers were all three of them active. Julio and Joel and Antonio, their sparring sessions between themselves were legendary.
Antonio Diaz actually had a pretty notable career. Beat Mickey Ward on HBO. Had
Ivan
battles
Robinson.
With Shane Mosley, yeah. Ivan Robinson.
Hector Quiros, remember that first fight? Good Lord.
Very, very honest fighter. Good, solid contender between 140 and 147 for about 6-7 years. In fact, one of the real staples of the boxing scene out here, he used to fight regularly, guys, at the Fantasy Springs, and they used to fight out in the parking lot.
That's
long
right.
Before this building
really?
Was ever.
He fought Corey Spinks in the parking lot here. Fought Omar Weiss in the parking lot here.
Oh, we got to get a parking lot show on Ring TV. I mean,
no, thank you.
Not in the summer.
We can't wear suits, though.
Either that or a swap meet fight.
I've done that before. For Beto, I still remember the De La Hoya Chavez fight, June of 1996, at Caesar's Palace before they built a hotel over it. It was only about 114 degrees at about 8:30 at night. So trust me, I like the nice air-conditioned buildings.
It's a dry heat.
Yeah.
It's a dry heat. A minute to go in the fight. Marco Magdaleno, he's working. In Spanish, there's a word. You say it's aguanta. Hugo Padilla, aguanta. It means he can take it. He can absorb it. He can hang. And that's... This is the reason that they brought him in, 3-6, but he's durable.
Yes, it's a combination of his ability to take a punch, but also his ability to elude a punch. Yeah. There's constant upper body movement from him, which is obviously why the Diaz brothers said, tap that body, break him down there.
You're not going to look good against Padilla.
No.
I think tonight what he's gotten is some good work. I thought he showed a better pacing. I think in the past, early on, that Magdaleno's been very frenetic. But again, looking at his body, I do think not only can get down to 130, I wonder if he could actually make the featherweight level. But again, he is 23 years old. He may grow out of that very soon.
10 seconds to go in the fight. Magdaleno has controlled it from the opening bell. Hugo Partilla has been game. And that'll do it. They go to this 4 rounds. We'll come back with the final decision from Indio on Ring TV Live.
Cinturones aquí se hacen a un lado. Hay que pelear por honor y por gloria nada más.
Liam's a talent. He'll fight anyone. We're going to make a big fight for him in the autumn. I think he's the biggest name in that division, and I will make sure it happens. And I believe by the end of the year, he will be the best.
Oh, it's getting cooler, only about 112 now. We started at 115, Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino, Indio, California, about 2 hours east of downtown LA. Waiting on the decision, there you see Marco Magdaleno, originally from Las Vegas. Now training in Coachella, Beto Duran, Doug Fisher, and Steve Kim, led by Will Wright tonight. Our ring announcer, the one and only, Joe Martinez.
Well, fine fans, after four rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards, and here are the totals. Both Eddie Hernandez and Fritz Warner have it 40-36. Ray Corona has it 39-37. All for your winner by unanimous decision and still undefeated, El Perro Grande, Marco Magdaleno.
Had to work for it. Marco Magdaleno improves to 4-0.
I thought it was a good performance from him. He was a little more measured than he was the last time we saw him out. I thought he got a little reckless last time. This time, sometimes he rushed himself a little bit. Sometimes he smothered his own punches, but he definitely wasn't reckless in there. And here are some highlights from it. From the onset, he was landing the overhand left. Beautiful. That was well timed. That was from mid-range. You see a lot of heart from Padilla, occasionally pressing the younger, stronger man, but usually it was Magdaleno who was all over Padilla.
And Magdaleno's making his way over to our setup right here in front of the blue corner. Be joined by him briefly. The 23-year-old Marco Magdaleno improves a 4-0. Marco, you can breathe, man. Let's fix your microphone a little bit. There we go. How you feeling, man? 4-0.
I feel good, you know. Another win, another great experience, and I'm ready for more. Anything you guys throw my way, I'm ready to take it on.
How does this performance compare with the last time we saw you up in this ring? What's changed about you?
This time, I wasn't too happy about my performance, you know.
Really?
Yeah, I came in, wanted to stop the guy again, you know, but he was a tough guy, and he kept coming forward, kept fighting, and... But we put on a great show for all the fans.
That might have been the matchmaker's lesson, is that you can't knock everybody out.
You can't knock everybody out, and I said
so
that before.
So when you figure out that this guy is just going to be pesky, either because he's durable or elusive or a combination of both, what in your mind do you have? What kind of adjustments do you have to make to your game?
The kind of adjustments I have to be more relaxed, let him come to me, you know, and just pick the right shots.
And we're going to see some of the highlights coming your way. You made a nice entrance there. Look good. Then the southpaw going up against a 37-year-old man who was able to withstand some of the pressure.
Oh, yeah. He was a tough guy. Caught him with an overhand. And, man, he was able to take that overhand very, very well. You know, he kept coming forward, kept fighting, and it was a great fight.
before the fourth round, your corner was just letting you have it. Left ear, right here, Joel and Antonio were going after it, though. But it doesn't faze you, though, right? You heard that instruction.
Yeah, I heard them, and I try to do as best as I can to listen to them. And, you know, we still came out with the victory.
Hey, last thing before the commission takes you away. Look at that camera. Let people know where they can get those shirts for Hayden.
Oh, for Hayden, you can contact me directly or my brothers, and we have PayPal set up, so we'll send them out to you guys.
So they should do that, like, through social media, maybe?
Through social media, yeah. And just let us know, and we'll send the shirts out your way.
There it is for Hayden Perry in Las Vegas right there. This guy Hayden, got the victory. He's now 4-0. We'll be back with more from Indio on Ring TV Live.
Los cinturones aquí se hacen a un lado. Hay que pelear por honor y por gloria nada más.
Liam's a talent. He'll fight anyone. We're going to make a big fight for him in the autumn. I think he's the biggest name in that division, and I will make sure it happens. And I believe by the end of the year, he will be the best.
Coachella Valley, that's that mountain that Doug Fisher climbed this morning. Did about 20 minutes, get a little track work. I usually do Sundays at UCLA, but he's ready to go. Hey, Coachella, back inside the Special Event Center. I'm Bethel Duran. Doug Fisher, of course, the editor of RingTV.com, and Steve Kim, one of the longtime boxing scribes, UCN Live and Boxing Steve. Before we get to Steve's news and notes, we have plenty of that before AZ Hovhannisyan comes in, the fella from Armenia. Joseph Diaz Jr. is here with us, fourth member of our crew, giving us some observation as he gets ready. Remember, he's fighting here July 30th in Indio at this same facility. Make sure you get your tickets at goldenboyboxing.com. But Jojo, you just saw Marcos Magdaleno fight, the brother of Diego Magdaleno. Remember when you only had four fights underneath your belt?
Yes, I do. And Marco Magdaleno, I thought he did a tremendous job. You can't always knock out your opponent. It's always good to get those rounds in and to gain that experience. His opponent was a tough veteran that knew how to survive, and it was always a great experience. I think that Marco Magdaleno has tremendous talent, and he could go far as long as he puts his mind to it. And
how do you
keeps
get there, though,
hard.
Jojo? How do you get there from being the kid who is really anxious at four rounders? What do you have to do to get to the next level? Take it up.
You know what? I think you just have to stay calm and just keep your patience, because patience is the key. He's still young in his career, so he's just going to be developing and fighting tougher opponents every time out. It's going to gain him that experience.
When you're in there in that ring, Jojo, and you faced this in your career when you were 21, 22, and then you're taking on a dude who's in his late 30s, a man, a guy who could be your dad maybe sometimes. What's the attitude like? Or what's the approach?
You know what? At first, you get a little jitters because you know that this guy has the manpower already, and you're still young in your career.
He can shave.
Yeah, yeah, right? And he can shave, too. You just got to realize that you trained very hard for this fight, and this is what you got to do. And you prepared well for this fight, so you got to go in there and conquer and show everybody what you got.
Just like Joseph Diaz prepared for it tonight, working the broadcast. We'll be checking up with him more and more as the night progresses. We're still working towards the main event with Rene Alvarado and Jason Velez, two guys that Jojo has defeated in his young career. Joseph Diaz, the 2012 Olympian, fights here July 30th. Now, news and notes. We already talked Pacquiao. Pacquiao, enough Pacquiao. We're done with the Philippines. Let's get back to the United States. What do you have for us right now, Steve Kim?
Well, the big story last week on Friday. Now, the last time we were here, I guaranteed, like Joe Namath, Chris Eubank would put his name on the dotted line, and Gennady Golovkin would be fighting in the UK at the O2 Arena. I got half that right. I'll be honest, Doug. I don't know about you, but when I checked Twitter on Friday morning, and I saw the fight poster for Gennady Golovkin, Kell Brook, did you think that was a meme?
I thought it was a hoax. Absolutely. I absolutely did.
Hey, you might have been a meme, but that tour is going on right now. They were in New York City.
Just
and
yesterday.
It sold out in 12 minutes. The British fans, Doug, you were there not too long ago. They go crazy.
They don't mess around. You can make a big event there. And guess what? Gennady Golovkin, the number one rated middleweight in the world, versus Kell Brook, the number one rated welterweight in the world. People might scoff at it here in the States. In the UK, it's a big deal. They want to see the big drama show, and they also want to cheer on their man.
And by the way, September 10th, on that same day, it'll be a day-night doubleheader on HBO. At the Forum, Chocolatito Roman Gonzalez will attempt to win his fourth world title at 115 against respected Mexican Carlos Cuadras. Now, also on that card, I don't know what the television situation is, but a fight that we saw on Tax Day, Kamagai against Soto Karas, that will be on the live portion of the show at the Forum. So a fun night of boxing, September 10th.
September 10th. That means there's a tailgate somewhere from the guru in the Forum. And that coming up right now, Mario Ayala, Super Mario from Sacramento, is in the ring. Parents are from Michoacan, Mexico. And there you go. There you see him. A.Z. Azat Hovhannisyan, Glendale, California, from Armenia, was a highly touted amateur in his day. Went to the 2009 Worlds, lost there. Of course, he's now training in Glendale, Hovhannisyan. Azat is a fighter who is 8-2, 7 KOs, and a good job by our crew finding that footage from overseas.
Oh, nice right hand. Very well timed.
The sources that Ring TV Live has, they get you there. Forget you two. We got people there recording it for us. Drones, GoPros, doing it all for you. And that's our fight coming up. Six rounds in the super bantamweight division. Azat Hovhannisyan, of course, was signed by his promotional company that is along with Vic Darchinian.
He looks good. He looks very polished. Nice technique. And it looks like he's got some power as well.
And there you see Mario Ayala, Joe Martinez.
The next bout tonight, six rounds, this in the super bantamweight division. Introducing to you first, finding out of the blue corner. Wearing white trunks, trimmed in gold and blue, he weighed at officially 121 pounds. In seven professional bouts, his record stands at 4 victories, 2 defeats, 1 draw with 1 win by way of knockout from Sacramento, California. Here is Super Mario Ayala! And his opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner. Wears blue, trimmed in white. He weighed in 122 pounds even. As a professional in 10 bouts, his record, 8 victories, 2 defeats, 7 big wins, coming by way of knockout, originally from Armenia and now fighting out of and residing in Glendale, California. Here is Crazy AZ Azat Hovhannisyan. And your referee in charge of the action is Ray Corona.
Let's go, 2 seconds. Mouthpiece. Good right here. Listen to my commands. Touch gloves. God bless.
Ray Corona, our third man in the ring with the instructions. Here comes the tell of the tape of these two.
Mario Ayala is 1 year younger. He is 2.5 inches taller, and he has a wingspan that is 2 inches longer.
Ready.
Get ready to go. Six rounds. Super bantamweight division. AZ Hovhannisyan in the blue with gold, gray trim. And all white is Super Mario Ayala. Hovhannisyan, almost 300 amateur fights. Started boxing as a young kid around the age of 10. As his trainer just told me before the fight, because he didn't know how to do anything else. He knew how to fight. So there it is. Go to the gym and keep on going. That's what he's been doing since the age of 10.
And Beto, on that note, Hovhannissian is a young man I've seen often at the wild card the last couple of years. I can honestly say he has some of the roughest sparring sessions you'll ever see at that gym. Not so much sparring, but really real fights with headgear.
Who's he going with in those?
Well, whoever is in between this weight class, between, let's say, 115 and 130, he'll get in there with it. I tell you what, he does not hold back a lot in the gym.
115 and 130, he goes after it, huh? Mario Ayala had a two-year layoff in the sport of boxing. He had lost two fights in a row in 2013, and he said that's it. He didn't feel like boxing anymore. Didn't really have a home gym. Was doing everything by himself. No real manager, no trainer. And as we know, in this sport, it can be very lonely, especially in Sacramento, not a big fighting scene. And he came back in 2015, had a couple wins and a draw, and he's feeling good. Stepping up in competition here against Azat Hovhannissian.
I think Hovhannissian is outclassing him to this point. You can really see the polish and the experience of those 300 plus amateur bouts.
Doug, I think there was a left hook on the inside that buzzed him right there. Ayala's having a hard time keeping Hovhannissian off him. He's not able to control that airspace, and Hovhannissian's just walking right through that front door.
Hovhannissian going in the southpaw stance. He said he feels very comfortable switching. He has power in both hands. And here he is stalking Ayala.
Does it? You know, he stalks very well.
Minute to go and in the opening round, scheduled for six.
He switches. He switches stances very well. And in some spots, he actually kind of reminds me of Victor Chinian, you know, with that, I don't know, the quirky way that he kind of shifts his shoulders before he lets his hands go.
Ayala's last fight, he was in there against Michael Gaxiola, the fighter Doug, you and I have seen him a couple of times. Not a heavy puncher. And that went the distance six rounds. Pretty sure he's looking at Hovhannissian right now like, okay, this is different. Hovhannissian with some power. Right hand, he's landing that right hand flush a couple of times in this round.
Beto, that was a lead. That was a lead right hand. He didn't set it up with anything. That just shows really good timing and judge of distance.
Hovhannissian living in Glendale by himself. Family's all in Armenia. The only family he has are the people in the gym. Looking good in the opening round is AZ Hovhannissian. It's scheduled for six in Indio. Ring TV Live cameras, you know it, they're everywhere. Got this interview package coming your way.
I get ready for this fight like 2 months. I passed great camp and I'm like ready for 150%. It's a first, I couldn't tell that first time I fight like in big card, like kind of as a De La Hoya card, like Golden Boy promotion, you know. It's more responsibility. And whatever it took, it's after this fight, I win, and it's more responsible to get like forward, to step forward. Fans is fans for, thanks for the, you know, fans for coming for this fight, but I will do whatever I will. I will knock him down.
Special guest tonight, Sugar Ray Leonard. Meet and greet with him. Probably the longest line we've seen here at Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino. He was actually on the golf course yesterday with Oscar De La Hoya, swinging the sticks. Pretty cool opportunity. Golden Boy always brings out a legend of the sport of boxing to every event here at Fantasy Springs. Right now we're watching Azat Hovhannissian, who brought a crowd with him. He had the Armenian flag flying around. He's in the blue trunks with Mario Ayala from Sacramento.
I am really impressed with what I've seen from Hovhannissian so far.
See, from what you're saying, the pace that Hovhannissian has right now is probably slower than his sparring session.
It really is. I mean, we have that term gym wars, and I'll say this. Hovhannissian's been in more than a few at the wild card, and he fights the way he spars. I mean, you take a look, he doesn't use a lot of setup jabs, throws a lot of lead hooks and lead right hands, and he's a guy that's going to mix it up. I really enjoy him because I think consistently he makes good television fights.
He's probably used to sparring with a higher level opponent than he's actually in with tonight. And not to disparage Ayala, because he does look competent. He doesn't look like he's a, he's got a temperament of a fighter, but so does Azat Hovhannissian. But Hovhannissian has a lot of polish, really nice, you know, tight technique, and there's some power that accompanies his shots.
You know, you look at Ayala's record, guys, 7 fights, only 1 knockout. So that's indicative of the fact he may not have heavy hands. You just wonder, can he keep Hovhannissian off of him? Can he throw something that'll make Hovhannissian think twice about just walking in a straight line.
Meanwhile, Hovhannissian 8-2, 7 KOs. He lost his pro debut in California in 2011. That was 4 rounds. And his other loss was 2014. He lost a majority decision to Walter Santibanez. His last time he was in the ring was in October here in Indio. And he knocked out Jesus Serrano in the 3rd round. Now I can see why the inactivity. I asked his trainers about that. So sometimes guys just don't want to take the fight. Yeah. I get it now.
Yeah, I can see that. I can see why. And Hovhannissian has been knocking guys out lately as well, apart from that majority decision loss.
Hovhannissian bouncing around there in the blue trunks. There you hear the Armenian crowd stepping up for him.
Hovhannissian looks very comfortable now.
Glendale Fighting Club. Isn't that what Ronda Rousey works out of also?
She used to.
Yeah.
She hasn't fought in a while.
Is that breaking news, Doug?
I believe I said works out of.
Yeah, there's something Dana White should be aware of.
Doug Kim's, Doug Fisher's news and notes coming your way, sponsored by. 20 seconds to go in the 2nd round. Hovhannissian controlling this one. Steve, every punch he throws of Hovhannissian is with
bad intentions, as they say.
Like that, right hand. Strong right, absorbed by Ayala, but that one stung. Another overhand right. Final seconds of the 2nd round. Ayala's getting tagged here.
Ayala trying to get some offense going, trying to work off his jab from mid-range. Hovhannissian shrugs it off because he blocked a lot of those shots. Comes under with the left, follows it with a left and a right cross to the head, and he's letting those punches go. There's a right to the body, left to the head, and there's his best punch of the round. Straight right to the head.
3rd round of action, Bethel Duran, Doug Fisher, and Steve Kim leading towards our main event, which features Jason Velez and Rene Alvarado. Hovhannissian corner, there's somebody pretty cool over there. We'll talk about it along with his trainers. Edwin Tarvibian is his trainer. And the cut man is John Bray. Now, there's a story recently about John Bray, guys, and he is battling Alzheimer's, but he's going to continue to fight as he's working here tonight.
Johnny Bray, one of the real true boxing guys in Southern California.
Yeah. One of my favorite people in boxing.
And he's watching Hovhannissian put on a show right now, letting the hands go. John Bray continues to fight the battle with Alzheimer's, 46 years old. He's in that corner working as he's watching Hovhannissian go to the body attack as Ayala's corner is telling him to get out of there. But it is too much from Hovhannissian right now. Ayala with a big knot underneath his left eye. As Hovhannissian, Doug, you mentioned earlier, a lead right has been landing with ease. As Hovhannissian now switches into the southpaw stance, and Ayala is breathing heavy.
Ayala really should have been using his height and his reach advantages, sticking a jab and employing a lot of lateral movement.
Body shot from Hovhannissian.
He doesn't have the physical strength to stand in and trade with Hovhannissian. And it's not just a matter of Hovhannissian's greater physical strength and punching power. He's just a much better technician.
Yeah. He's clever. I mean, there's a method to the madness. He sets a very, very quick pace. And you see what he does there, a lot of head movement, almost Mike Tyson-esque with the peekaboo style, changing angles on the way in, getting his head nice and low. And you get the sense He's willing to take one to give two. It's a very, very high octane, high offensive style.
Well, that's what reminds me of Vic Darchinian. The flyweight junior bantamweight version of Darchinian was very much like that. He had strange, awkward angles that he operated from, but he made it work for him.
Ayala's landed some shots here in the round. A little bit of a mouse underneath the left eye of Hovhannissian, but he's absorbing it and keeps on coming. This dude has a motor.
Beto, that mouse is not going to be so small. In fact, it's growing right in front of us, and that's certainly going to be an issue for the cut man here. They better get that end swell out, but he is getting assaulted over and over with that overhand right of Hovhannissian.
It's been one-sided to begin with, but it's starting to become punishing for Ayala. If they can't get him to change his tactics and do something that works in there, I think Ayala's corner should really think about maybe keeping him on the stool.
Young fighter. 26 years old, final seconds of the round. It's scheduled for six.
Oh yeah, ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Crazy AZ Azad Hovhannissian taking on Mario Ayala. July 30th, ladies and gentlemen, get your tickets. They are on sale right now.
Azmat Hovhannissian on the attack, overwhelming Ayala, working the body and the head. It's the right, it's the left. When he misses with the left, he's always in position to fire off with his right.
JoJo's in the house right now, sitting ringside, watching Crazy AZ. Get ready for Joseph
Jojo Diaz, July 30th. Move the feet. He's keeping his mouthpiece in.
Yeah, that's a mistake. That's a rookie mistake by his corner. They should remove that because he can refresh himself by getting water in the mouth. He can also get more oxygen with the mouthpiece out.
Breathing's good, right?
Breathing's a good thing for boxers, yes. Oxygen, good.
Fourth round is scheduled for six. Hovhannissian from Armenia, now living and training in Glendale in the blue. Controlled this fight from the opening bell, landing the bigger shots.
Hovhannissian has a nice left to the body. Throws it from a really good angle where it's hard for his opponent to hit him in return. And I wonder something, Steve, and I kind of want your opinion on this. A guy like Hovhannissian who's able to get the job done without working a jab, do you teach him a jab?
No.
For when he's, would that take away from his style?
You know, Customato once said square pegs don't die round, and this works for him.
Wait, hold on. Square pegs
don't die round.
Man, I got to write all these down. Yeah, you're coming strong tonight.
Customato was a pugilistic philosopher, but this is what he does. And what I see in the gym is what I'm seeing tonight. And I got to tell you, we have a fight series called LA Fight Club locally at the Belasco Theater. I would like to see more of Hovhannissian in with some of the guys that we see. I think he's a very, very tough knight at the office. Strong physical fighter. And, you know, he can employ the jab if he wants to, but he's very sneaky. And when guys are able to throw lead right hands or lead hooks, that means they have a great sense of distance and timing. And he actually does a nice job of actually punching in between his opponent's attack also.
That's boxing ability, Steve.
Hovhannissian bouncing around that ring. Really in control of this fight. He keeps his hands down a bit at times. As Ayala's landed some shots, but not with much power behind them.
Hats off to Ayala. He's taking a lot of punishment.
He's tough.
And he's not just trying to survive. He's actually trying to punch back. He's trying to survive. Just doesn't have the physical strength and the punching power to back Azad off.
Well, there's a swarm from Hovhannissian, like the flies around this building right now. Just don't go away.
No, but more like hornets because there's sting to his shots.
50 seconds to go in the fourth round. All Hovhannissian, the Armenian fighter. Body work.
And this has been the second really one-sided punishing round that goes against Ayala. And again, I'll state this for the record. I think his corner should maybe consider keeping him on the stool.
You know, the heart is willing, but the body isn't. If you look at Ayala's punches, very, very flaccid. Not a lot of leverage on him, throwing more and more arm punches. And we note again, only one knockout in seven fights coming into this contest.
Hovhannissian has won his last four fights by knockout. Big shot. 10 seconds to go. Another big right from Hovhannisyan. Been all Armenia in this fight.
Hovhannisyan closing distance, tagging the body with the left, coming over with the right, landing another right cross. Landing another right cross. That was another lead, short right. Nice and straight, accurate. A lot of leverage on those shots as well. And you notice the difference between corners. Edwin Tarverbian, is that how you pronounce it? Ronda Rousey's trainer, he had Hovhannisyan's mouthpiece out, and he's I don't understand Armenian, but you could tell he's talking to him very calmly and giving him clear instructions.
You could see early on in this round, Hovhannisyan really starting to step with that right hand. He may be trying to put on a finishing kick here. I think Ayala may be on the verge of just falling over.
In the fifth round, scheduled for six, super bantamweight division, 122-pounders, Hovhannisyan in the blue. Bethel Duran, Doug Fisher, Steve Kim, and Joseph Diaz from Indio, California. As the pressure is starting to mount from Hovhannisyan, and Ayala just swinging with his arms, nothing but behind those.
Yeah, he's out of ideas. He's not even trying to box from a distance. I know he is trying to punch between Hovhannisyan's volleys, but Hovhannisyan is difficult to anticipate because of that unique style that he has. And right now, poor Mario, his only option is to take a beating.
Which is what he's doing, getting right now.
Trying to move around a little bit now.
And a lot of heart.
I think he should stick to this, to be quite honest.
Mario Ayala, a lot of heart, and down goes Ayala for the first time tonight. Only a matter of time as Hovhannisyan been landing the bigger shots all evening. And he finally knocks one down in the fifth. Referee Ray Corona checking the fighter. Tell them you got to defend yourself. Ayala takes a deep breath. Hovhannisyan goes to the body. Ayala trying to survive. Hovhannisyan in the blue, just swarming him. The Armenian fans on their feet. They anticipating something here. And Ayala is just wearing it right now. How much punishment is his corner going to let him take? As the body work from Hovhannisyan. More body work. Chin check with the left from Hovhannisyan. On the ropes is Ayala in front of his own corner. He's trying to throw back, but Hovhannisyan just swarming him. The Armenian fighter letting his hands go. Somebody is just watching his fighter take too much. Ray Corona is right there. There's a lot of heart from Ayala, but my goodness,
he's overwhelmed,
it is good. Ray Corona, great job stopping it finally.
Well, I got to tell you one thing. I was looking at this corner right here. They had the towel in the hand, but honestly, the only thing tougher than Ayala tonight was his corner.
That's never a good thing.
Young fighter at the age of 26, took a beating, a lot of heart, a lot of credit, Super Mario. You came to fight.
Yes,
he did.
But
it was too much. Azat Hovhannisyan tonight.
Hovhannisyan, I think, Doug, is the very definition of a two-fisted attack.
Yes, he is. Yeah, he's a fighter. He's a boxer fighter is how I would describe his style. But there's a lot of technique to go with that sort of unique aggressive style, and obviously it comes from more than 300 amateur bouts and being an elite level amateur. If he made it to the 2009 World Amateur Championships, that should tell you something. He's a top class amateur, and we're seeing the class right now. Beautiful right cross, right to the temple of Ayala, sends the game fighter from Sacramento to the canvas, and really the fight could have been stopped, waved off here. But Ayala got up, gamely, is trying to stand in there. But when you see a professional fighter just lower his head like that and swing,
well,
sort of like
drowning.
Yeah,
he's
like
drowning,
like somebody
who
doesn't know how to fight, that means he's totally, not just outclassed, but overwhelmed.
Yeah, and I'll say this about Ayala. He had a lot of physical attributes. It'll be interesting to see if Azat Hovhannissian in the future, how does he deal with a taller guy that can actually jab and really create some distance, but really impressive tonight.
And let's go to Joe Martinez.
Ladies and gentlemen, the end comes at the official time. 2:18, round number 5. Referee Ray Corona steps in and puts a halt to this bout. Your winner by KO victory, Crazy AZ, Azat Hovhannissian.
Azat Hovhannissian puts on a show at the wild card sparring. He came out and put a show in India when it mattered. He is now 9-2 with 8 stoppages in his young career. There you see the Armenian fighter. They call him Crazy AZ, Azat Hovhannissian. We'll be back with more from Indio on Ring TV Live.
Los cinturones aquí se hacen a un lado. Hay que pelear por honor y por gloria nada más.
Liam's a talent. He'll fight anyone. We're going to make a big fight for him in the autumn. I think it's the biggest name in that division, and I will make sure it happens. And I believe by the end of the year, he will be the best.
Year-old Cesar Diaz from Palmdale, California, warming up. You will see him at 7 o'clock Pacific time. Then after that, Rashidi Ellis and Jason Velez takes on Rene Alvarado at the Fancy Springs Resort and Casino in Indio, California. Saw 3 fights in the books. John Leon from Colombia, first round stoppage. Marco Magdaleno from Coachella, a 4-round decision. He's now 4-0. And Azat Hovhannissian improves to 9-2 with a 5th-round KO. So at 7 o'clock Pacific time, come back here, Ring TV Live, as 3 more fights are coming your way from Indio. You've been watching Ring TV Live.
gentlemen, making his pro debut here from Palmdale, California, Cesar Diaz! Every time I'm on the AM show, the security is maximum and at the wall.
Go The Boy Promotions is on the road in the desert heat. It's about 114 today. Sun is setting, and the action's still going to stay on fire inside the ring. There you see pro debut, Cesar Diaz from Palmdale, Rashidi Ellis from Boston. Our main event, Boricua, Jason Velez against Nicaragua, Rene Alvarado. That's coming up next on Ring TV Live. About 2 hours east of downtown Los Angeles is the beautiful Coachella Valley, home to world-class golf, and that's the Eagle Falls course right next to Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino. A very tough course where yesterday Oscar De La Hoya and Sugar Ray Leonard were playing. The sun is setting in India, getting ready for another edition of Golden Boy Boxing on Ring TV Live. Thank you for joining us tonight on the 15th of July. The crowd is milling around, getting ready for more action coming up right now. And alongside the editor of ringtv.com, Doug Fisher, and longtime boxing scribe from UCN Live and boxingscene.com, Steve Kim, and the host of not one, but two podcasts, I'm Bethel Duran. Thank you for joining us tonight. And our main event, Doug, is two fighters that it's a crossroads fight. Boricua, Jason Velez, coming off two losses, and El Gemelo, Rene Alvarado from Nicaragua, who has seven losses in his career.
Yeah, you said it right. It's a crossroads match. We're talking about two young but battle-tested fringe contenders, guys who have either been to the big dance, like Jason Velez. He just fell short in a featherweight title challenge. Here he is swapping leather with Joseph Diaz Jr. He was game. He was competitive in that fight, but he came up short. He doesn't want to be viewed as a stepping stone for more Joseph Diaz Jr.'s. He wants to get back into title contention. In order to become a top 10 contender, he's got to beat Rene Alvarado tonight, Steve.
And we take a look at Rene Alvarado. This is last summer at the Los Angeles Sports Arena, a hot human night. He gave him 10 rounds of good work, but eventually dropped a decision. And guys, he has lost three out of his last four, but this hard-nosed Nicaraguan is also a hard, tough out, losing to the likes of Tino Avila and Andrew Concio. Not so sure if this is necessarily a must-win situation for either guy, but Doug, I think it certainly would be a good idea.
Yeah, I mean, in the court of public opinion, if whoever loses here, he's going to be viewed as a gatekeeper, whether the fighter likes it or not.
And both these fighters have gone up against 2012 Olympian and undefeated hot prospect Joseph Jojo Diaz Jr., who's a fourth member of our crew. Jojo will be giving us analysis throughout the night as we work towards the main event. And Jojo, you know these two fighters very well. What do you expect to see tonight when these two warriors go at it?
You know what? I'm expecting a war. Jason Velez and Rene Alvarado are both tremendous fighters. I was able to share the ring with both fighters, and I know that they come to win. These guys are very tough fighters, and I know that it's going to be a war because it's a must-win for both of these fighters, because the winner, I know that, is going to be on to bigger, better things. So it's going to be a very tough fight, and I just can't wait to see what's going to happen.
Jojo will have analysis throughout the night, but right now, making his way to the Ring TV Live cameras yesterday was 18-year-old standout amateur and now professional, making his pro debut, Cesar Diaz from Palmdale, California, and he has an interesting background.
In my amateur career, I did a little over 108 fights. You know, I won a lot of tournaments and I beat a lot of great fighters. I beat two of the fighters that are going to the Olympics right now, and you know, I did my part and now it's time for me to turn pro. So making the jump from amateur to professional, you know, I feel like I have to work on setting down my punches and not using my punches too much on speed, but more setting them down into power punches, and that's the way to go. When I heard that I was gonna make my pro debut as a TV opener, you know, it motivated me more, and you know, I was excited. I'm so excited right now. I just wanna show everyone what I got. As a professional fighter, I would want to make my career big, you know, into a world champion. So a lot of people say that I fight like Eric Morales, you know, in his prime time. And, you know, I see myself like that too. The way that he's a brawler, he likes to brawl, and then at the same time, he likes to counter you, and that's the style I like too. Fans could expect explosiveness, you know, speed, power.
And there he is, wearing that red hat. No, it's not for Cincinnati. It's for Caesar. 18-year-old Caesar Diaz, Palmdale, California, ready to make his ring walk for the first time as a professional. He's fought in this building before, the Desert Showdown, the different amateur competitions, but there you see him making the ring walk. Cesar Omar Diaz from Palmdale, California. Mom and dad are from Jalisco, Mexico, but he was born in Aguascalientes, Mexico, 18-year-old. He turns 19 tomorrow.
Hey, I'm looking forward to watching this guy fight. I expected to see him fight, make his pro debut on the Vargas Salido undercard. He made it all the way to the weigh-in, and then his opponent came in way too heavy. That fight got scratched.
But he did have a photo shoot that day he was able to take advantage of.
Yeah, I was about ready to interview him for Ring TV Live at the weigh-in. All I can say is, hey, your fight just got scratched. Better luck next time, kid.
And there's his opponent, Isaul Primo Dueñas, Houston, Texas, where he trains, but he lives in Monterrey, Nuevo León, Mexico. As Vicente Fernandez is blaring all over the Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino, we'll be going to the ring announcer Joe Martinez in a moment. This is the first fight coming your way. After this, Rashidi Ellis, Luis Hernandez, Lynn, Massachusetts against Bayamon, and another Boricua, Jason Velez, and Rene Alvarado is our main event. You see the Diaz brothers, Joel and Antonio, in his corner. Joel Diaz actually manages Cesar Diaz. No relation, but they know him very well. Diaz trainer is Sam Contreras. We'll get more into the background he has with the Diaz. They know each other very well. Over 100 amateur fights, Diaz beat a lot of the U.S. Olympians, but because he was born in Mexico, could not qualify for any international thing for the United States, so he didn't want to go fight for Team Mexico because he considers himself more of an American. And we'll get more into that details. Here's Joe Martinez.
Por cuatro asaltos en el peso super gallo. And here we go, fight fans. Four rounds of action this scheduled in the super bantamweight division. Los tres jueces por ese combate, the three judges scoring this bout at ringside, Rey Corona, Eddie Hernandez, and Fritz Werner. And when the action begins inside the ring, your referee in charge, encargado de ring, el referee David Mendoza. Presentado primero en la esquina azul, con los pantaloncillos plateado con blanco y un peso de 125 libras y un cuarto. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. Wearing silver, trimmed in white, he weighed officially 125 and one quarter pounds. Tonight, he enters the ring for the seventh time as a professional, un veterano de seis peleas de Monterrey, Mexico, presentando Isaul Primo Dueñez. Is oponente en la esquina roja, con los pantaloncillos rojo con blanco y un peso de 120 libras y medias. His opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wears red with white and weighted officially 120 and one half pounds. Esta noche él está haciendo su debut profesional tonight, making his professional debut and hailing from Palmdale, California, here is Cesar Omar Diaz.
Come on up here. Come on up here. Gentlemen, we've gone over the rules and the fouls. Protect yourself at all times. Follow my instructions. All right, touch gloves. Return to your corner.
David Mendoza, the third man in the ring tonight. The tail of the tape, Doug.
Wow, Cesar Diaz, 7 years younger. Really more like 6 years younger at age 18. He turns 19 tomorrow. He is much taller, and he has the advantage in reach.
Just cool to say, though, he's only 18, making his pro debut. There you go. 19, by that time you're old. He has a cheering section. There you see him in the red shirts on top of your screen. Cesar Diaz in the white and red trunks. It says Omar across his belt. That is his middle name. Over 100 amateur fights. At one point, there was a three-year stretch where he did not lose a tournament. Good right hand from Cesar Diaz immediately opens up the eyes of Isaul Dueñas, a rugged 1-5. Body work from Diaz. Diaz went to Knight High School in Palmdale, California. Palmdale, about an hour and a half north of downtown Los Angeles. Trains with Sam Contreras. They met at the age of 11. Contreras was training his own son. Saw Diaz at the gym, said, I'm going to keep an eye on this kid. He has something about him. Ran into him 2 years later. Diaz, by that time, was training somewhere else. They hooked up at the age of 13, and they haven't looked back since. And they've been working out. Contreras has a gym that he built in his backyard. Weights, a setup. They finally got a somewhere there. But they go all over Southern California for sparring because not much sparring in Palmdale. And that's how they met the Diaz brothers. He has sparred Diego De La Hoya. That opened up the eyes of Joel and said, you know what? This kid, as an amateur, is cracking with Diego a few months ago. I need to invest in him. And that's where he signed him as his fighter. And now Joel Diaz manages him.
And Beto, you talk about Duane as 1-5 on the surface, not a very strong record, but it has to be noted, I think the combined record of those opponents is 15-0, and beyond that, all losses have been four-round decisions, so it would not be a surprise if we saw some rounds tonight in the debut of Cesar Diaz.
And we love our social media here. You're watching this on ringtvlive.com. We'll use the hashtag ringtvlive. Ask us questions on Twitter during the fight tonight. We do check them all, especially the messages that get mad because Doug didn't answer their mailbag. Less than a minute to go in the opening round, scheduled for four. Cesar Diaz in the white and red. Body work. Boy,
oh,
he
hurt him.
That hurt Duenas.
Yeah, that right cross buzzed Duenas. Absolutely.
Duenas from Monterey said he loves the sport of boxing because he loves to get into fights. Started boxing at the age of 16. He said because he's wanted to fight more. He was fighting in the streets, and there he's getting worked in the body by the 18-year-old Cesar Diaz.
Yeah, Duenas is in a fight right now, but he's in there with a very skilled young boxer. I love the jab and the variation of jabs that you see from Diaz, and plus his 1-2 combination. Yeah. It's very crisp.
Body work by Diaz. This kid does not look like he's making his pro debut at the age of 18. Final seconds of the opening round. Making his pro debut and fighting under the Golden Boy banner is Cesar Omar Diaz. Roberto Diaz, matchmaker for Golden Boy, no relation on the young 18-year-old.
Cesar was supposed to debut June 4th. Unfortunately, his opponent was very irresponsible, came in 9 pounds heavy. It was just, that's the hardest thing, you know, to look at your guy or the opponent even and say, sorry, I have no words for this, but it happens, especially in these fights, the pro debuts, the four-rounders, not the most professional, and it was unfortunate it happened. I know he had a lot of fans and friends and family coming out to see him, so we're excited to have him, and hopefully makes the television cut right there, opening up, and you know, we get to see Cesar this time, hopefully the opponent. We've been monitoring him, making sure there's no issues with weight, and we get to see him do his pro debut, and we're really excited to see him in the ring.
Second round of action. Of course, the Golden Boy fighters are watching. Emilio Sanchez in the 818 watching the Pacquema. Came on off coming a nice victory at the LA Fight Club. Thanks for watching, checking in, Emilio. 22-year-old undefeated prospect for Golden Boy. Right now in the second round, Cesar Diaz, white with red. Aguascalientes on the back of his trunks. That's where he was born. Good opening round for a fighter making his pro debut.
Yeah, Beto, you noted he doesn't look like he's making his pro debut. Looks like he's got some pro experience under his belt already, and it's because he does more than just jab and throw straight right hands. He's got beautiful body work and nice, crisp hooks and crosses, and he puts the punches together very well.
Beto, Doug, I just love his stance. That's a classic, fundamentally sound boxing stance. Chin down, front shoulder angled, not giving a flat surface to hit. And you see the way he punches with his legs through his core. He gets a lot of leverage on those hooks. He just looks like a pro, much more seasoned than a pro debut. And he seems to fight with a lot of poise.
Good foundation. Like you said, his stance is very good. And it's the kind of stance and he has the kind of style that he's going to get the most out of his height and his reach advantages because he is pretty tall for a junior featherweight / bantamweight.
And I tell you what, he is punching downhill right now. He's getting a lot of leverage and torque on both his right hand over the top and the left hooks.
Steve, you've heard the term Tijuana taxi cab driver?
Yeah, Greg Hogan taught us that. Way back in 1993, he said, Julio Cesar Chavez, he's 90-0, but he fought 85 Tijuana taxi cab drivers. One of the great quotes of recent boxing ilk.
Isaul Duenas is not a cab driver. He is a chauffeur. He drives a limo in Monterey. That's what he does. And all of his fights have been in the United States, all in Texas. He comes to scrap. He said he's going to be in there, and he's going to try to mix it up. I think he didn't expect this much from Cesar Diaz. Duenas said that because he has experience, he felt that was going to help him. But Diaz is just looking smooth in that ring in his second pro round.
Duenas is trying. He's trying to punch back, but he just can't find range as of yet. He landed a few shots in the opening round. Hasn't had any luck in the second round.
Joel Diaz, who's managing Diaz, and is in that corner, but he's not the one giving the main instructions, said that he saw with him that he has heart and potential. And Joel Diaz is not going to just take somebody into his jams. We talked about earlier with Marco and Diego and Jesse Magdaleno. You got to come in there for a reason.
I know. Yeah, Joel Diaz hands out compliments like manhole covers. You don't hear that. That's a Steve Kim line, by the way. You don't hear him praise a lot of young up-and-comers unless they are really something special.
Three sisters, one brother does Diaz have. He's the second of the clan. Stiff jab, final seconds, good uppercut from the 18-year-old from Palmdale.
Beautiful left hook connects for Diaz. Follows it up with a straight right, a left of the body, and that straight right back to the head. It's kind of a shotgun jab that he puts out there, at least from the distance. Follows it up with a short right cross to the temple. This young man has beautiful punch variation.
And I think they might be stopping this. David Mendoza was in the corner. Did he wave it off? It looked like he was going to wave it off, and he's asking Duenas, do you want to continue? And we are going to continue. Mm. He put his hands up, but David Mendoza, the referee, is in there checking it. Va a seguir, vamos. All right, seguir, keep going. I said vamos just because I don't know.
Diaz started to celebrate. He's got to get his game face back on. He thought it was over.
Well, let's see how he comes out and attacks this round. That means Duenas in that corner. Mendoza saw something from the Mexican fighter.
Boy, you could just tell how much leverage Diaz gets on every punch. He really does look like a really finely tuned offensive machine early on.
Body work upstairs and a big, big shot
to the body.
Hurting.
I'm surprised Duenas stayed standing. And kudos to Duenas, he's come out firing. Yep. And he's landed some shots of his own.
Mendoza will be looking very closely.
That was a nice right to the solar plexus from Duenas. Duenas is, if he's going to go down, he's going to go down swinging. And I tip my cap to him.
Cajones coming in from Duenas. Monterrey.
And what I like about Duenas, when he does fire back, it's not just one shot at a time. He's putting his punches together. Just doesn't have the snap that Diaz has on his punches. Diaz delivers every shot with so much more leverage.
Diaz, as Avril Lavigne once sang, he was just a skater boy. That's what he was as an 8-9-year-old kid, messing around the streets. The dad said, stop skating, get into the gym, go do something. He didn't want to play other sports. He said, what about boxing? And that's been ever since. Maybe that skating coordination has helped him out because he is just
he's got good balance.
You know, that was a beautiful sequence right there. He dug to the body and he moved his head and he was able to slip a few punches.
Two punches.
Yeah, Diaz does a very nice job of staying disciplined, of punching and
that
moving his head, and that's
David Mendoza steps in, protects the fighter and Duenas, Cesar Diaz in his pro debut on the eve of his 19th birthday gets the third round stoppage.
I think this was impressive given the fact that I know the record was 1-5, but the one thing about Duane is he was durable. And Cesar Diaz, a day before his 19th birthday, becomes the first guy to stop this guy. And I thought Duane was very game, and I thought the stoppage was very well timed.
Great point there, Steve. First time Duane has been stopped in his career. He's, you know, he's tougher than his record indicates.
Yeah, absolutely. And he can pull a Jake LaMotta and say, I never went down.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that veteran matchmakers will tell you is knowing how to read a box record, a boxing record. It's not just about the record. Because we know Cesar Diaz is a prized young recruit. They're not going to throw him in early. So you want to get him a victory, but you also want to get him the appropriate type of work. And I thought tonight, Doug, they really did that.
Yeah, and I think you can put a young man like Diaz in a little bit tougher than your average kid making his pro debut because of his amateur background, because of the fact that he was ranked number 3 in the country at featherweight as an amateur and that he has over 100 amateur wins. And just from what, you know, Golden Boy gleans from the gym stories, you know, from what they've heard, you know, they can talk to Diego De La Hoya and say, can this kid fight or not? Diego's going to say yes. They can put him in tough.
18-year-old Cesar Diaz, Palmdale, Jalisco, Aguascalientes. Your kid is now 1-0. The sun is setting in Indio, coming back with more. Watching Golden Boy Live on Ring TV Live.
Los cinturones aquí se hacen a un lado. Hay que pelear por honor y por gloria nada más.
Liam's a talent, he'll fight anyone. And we're going to make a big fight for him in the autumn. I think he's the biggest name in that division, and I will make sure it happens. And I believe by the end of the year, he will be the best.
Inside the Special Event Center at the Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino, Bethel Duran, Doug Fisher, and Steve Kim. Also, Joseph Diaz around the ring. And our ring announcer, Joe Martinez.
5 seconds, el tercero asalto de referee para la pelea para el ganador por knockout. The end comes officially 1:55. Round number 3, your winner by KO in his professional debut, Cesar Omar Diaz.
There it is. Turns 19 on Saturday, 1-0. Third round stoppage. Did not look like a kid making his pro debut.
You know, the word that comes to mind, Beto, is command. He I thought, showed a professional poise. And what was really impressive is the way he was able to bend that front knee and get to the body. He looked like a 5-year pro doing that. Very, very advanced offensive skill set for Cesar Diaz.
Cesar Omar Diaz. In a Spanish interview, anybody can do the Spanish interviews.
Yeah.
English ones.
Yeah.
They get you. Pressure over here on Ring TV Live.
Let's look at some highlights of young Cesar Diaz. Man, nice combinations, body and head.
You know what's impressive here, Doug, is a lot of young amateurs come into this sport and they throw a lot of punches and it is quantity over quality. Look at the precision that he has and the accuracy, and he knows exactly where he's placing his punches and does a good job of moving his head after combinations, resetting himself, resetting the distance, and coming right back down to the body. I got to tell you, Cesar Diaz, every young prospect, I say, what do you want to see from them? And I always say at the end of the night, I want me to say, I want to see more.
Yes.
I want to see more of Cesar Diaz.
Yeah, likewise. Absolutely. I wonder if he can make 118 pounds. Yeah. He weighed in at about 120 and a half. He's just 19 years old, or will be tomorrow. If he can make 118 and maintain that weight for a while, man, he will be a monster. People will compare him to Carlos Zarate.
Yeah.
Because he's going to get a lot of guys out of there.
And I think he's coming over here.
Oh, goody.
David we get Mendoza to talk to the young the man. Stoppage. As he's over there shaking hands with Joseph Diaz, you know.
Real recognizes real.
Anybody can go.
Congratulations.
You know, anybody can go say hi to Joseph Diaz. I mean, but you come and talk to Beth Duran and Doug Fisher.
Okay.
There we go. Congratulations, a third round stoppage. First fight as a pro under your belt. How do you feel right now?
I feel good. I was motivated to fight, and, you know, we were ready. We did our work, and we're ready for whatever's next.
Did you do what you set out to do tonight? What was your game plan coming in, and what kind of performance did you want to give the people tonight?
My game plan to come out tonight was to pressure the fight, always stay on him, keep the jab on him, and that's what we came out to do.
You gave him pressure, but it's funny. We didn't really talk about the pressure because we were so taken aback by your punch precision, your combinations and all. But, yeah, you were walking him down the entire fight, weren't
you?
What's the biggest difference you felt from an amateur to tonight?
Well, throughout the amateurs, I always had that. People always used to tell me that I had that professional style.
Okay.
And, it's a lot different. You don't use headgear no more. The gloves are a lot smaller.
You feel more stronger?
Yeah, a lot stronger, and, you know, it's a lot better. I like it. I had fun.
You feel you see things better without the headgear?
Yeah, you see a lot more things.
Did you, Doug and Steve were talking about this. Can you make 118?
You know what? We can make 118, and first we wanted to try 122. But now, you know, now we're ready to, yeah, I caught him with the right hand.
You buzzed him in that first round.
Yeah.
But you know what I like is you didn't go crazy. You saw that you hurt him, and you didn't throw caution to the wind.
I always had to keep him on the distance. I didn't want to get too smothered in with him.
Well, you've seen other guys make their pro debut, and you know you see like in the Caesar when they come out, and all of a sudden they're like Doug said, they get shot out of a rocket, and they're just all over the place, and their corner has to tell them, calm down. You get 3 minutes in the pros, right? Why were you so calm?
You know what? I had a really great corner. I had Joel Diaz. I had Antonio Diaz. And my trainer, Samuel Contreras. And, you know, with them, I feel so comfortable and so calm. You know, we came out and we did our thing.
Palmdale, California. There's a camera right there, that little GoPro. Check it out. Send your shout-outs. Go ahead, man.
Shout-out to all my family, my friends that came out here to support me. And, you know, we're ready for whatever's next. Keep supporting me, and I love my fans.
Palmdale, California. What's your Instagram?
What?
Your Instagram. What is it?
It's CesarOmar97.
CesarOmar97. I'm about to follow it. Get on it
likewise.
Right there with me. He's now 1-0, 18-year-old, and happy birthday tomorrow,
man. Yeah, tomorrow's my birthday.
Ahorita vamos a cantar las mañanitas like they would in Aguascalientes, where he was born. We'll be back with more in Indio. You're watching Ring TV Live.
Welcome back to Indio, California, Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino, where we are at tonight, a home away from home for Golden Boy Boxing on Beto Duran, alongside Steve Kim, Doug Fisher, and Joseph Diaz Jr. And of course, we are very active on social media. We're getting upset because we can't tweet as much as we want to, but our crack Ring TV Live staff has it hooked up. Weigh in tonight on Twitter. For those of you who think we'll win tonight's main event, go to twitter.com/GoldenBoyBoxing. Vote now. You can vote throughout the night, but early results are coming back. Let's see what we got.
Oh.
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 The red and the blue states.
This is reminiscent of 2000, Bush and Gore.
Oh, no hanging chads here.
Yeah.
We're going to get a decision between the Boricua and the Nicaraguan. Rene Alvarado continue to use that. Coming up from Lynn, Massachusetts. There you see him, Rashidi Ellis, outside the Boston suburb. He's coming in ready to make that ring walk. And let's look at the past fights for Rashidi Ellis. He was on the last Canelo card.
Yes, he was at the T-Mobile Arena in Las Vegas on the Canelo Con undercard. And this is him in action against Marco Lopez, who he outpointed over 8 rounds. And I was impressed with him. I was impressed with his reflexes, his speed, the torque on the end of his punches. I was especially impressed because he had been out of the ring for more than a year, and he didn't show a lot of ring rust.
And one note here, he was originally scheduled for the show that takes place at this very same venue on July 30th as our original main event dropped out with Alfonso Gomez's elbow injury. Rashidi Ellis was given the call and the opportunity to be bumped up on the televised portion of this card. He's fighting at an unnaturally high weight, more of a welterweight. Tonight he's fighting as a junior middleweight, but he takes the opportunity because he was ready to go.
Rashidi Ellis making his way to the ring, trained by Alex Rivera.
And he's in the spirit, literally dancing his way to the ring. Some Puerto Rican music, and he's fought in Puerto Rico and in the Dominican Republic numerous times.
Rashidi Ellis trained by a Boricua, Alex Rivera. Ellis sat down with our Ring TV Live crew.
Oh, I feel strong, I feel ready, even though it was short notice, but think about me, I'm always in the gym, so it's no big deal. Oh, I started boxing with my older brother because he used to go to the gym. He used to come home and tell me all the things about boxing, and he used to beat me up a little bit. Then I was like, oh, I want to go to the gym, I want to try it. Then, you know, going to the gym, then I just love it ever since. Mayweather, Eldrick Taylor, Roy Jones, Sugar Ray. I think I'm just a mixture of all. Just mixed all in a bunch. I find anybody, it really don't matter. Just watch me, you know, see something great about me. Show you something that everybody don't have. My fans can expect fireworks from this fight because, you know, I'm finding a good opponent. I got a good record. Because, you know, he's a good opponent, so he's gonna make me fight too, you know, and the best out of me.
Rashidi Ellis!
Eddie Hernandez, David Mendoza, and Fritz Werner. When the bell rings, your referee in charge, encargado de ring, referee Zach Young. Presentaron primero la esquina azul, con los pantaloncillos multicolores y un peso de 152 libras y medias. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing multicolored trunks, he weighed in officially 152 and 1/2 pounds. Un veterano de 13 peleas, su récord, 12 victorias con 7 ganadas y solamente una derrota. His professional record in 13 bouts, outstanding with 12 victories, just one defeat. 7 wins by way of knockout, presentando el Boricua de Bayamón, Puerto Rico, Luis La Roca Hernández. Y su oponente en la esquina roja, con los pantaloncillos azul y negro y un peso de 156 libras y medias. His opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wears blue with black trim. He weighed officially 156 and 1/2 pounds. Con un récord perfecto de 15 victorias, 0 derrotas y 11 ganadas por knockout, his professional record stands perfect in 15 bouts, 15 victories, no defeats, 11 wins by way of knockout. Here's the undefeated slugger from Boston, Massachusetts, Speedy Rashidi Ellis.
Chief second mouthpiece, chief second and mouthpiece. Got the mouthpiece in, Rashidi?
Mouthpiece.
Get that mouthpiece in there. Okay, ya hablamos sobre las reglas antes. We already spoke about the rules. These trunks are a little high. Esto un poquito arriba. But you can work from here on up. Yeah, arriba. Okay? No hay nada que decir más. Buena suerte. Good luck.
Zach Young, referee, with the instructions. He's the third man in the ring. Here's the tail of the tape, Doug.
Ellis is 7 years younger. He's 2 inches taller, and he has a slight reach advantage.
Rashidi Ellis, trained by Puerto Ricans Alex Rivera, who know the music scene well. They know Daddy Yankee, Don Omar. And you mentioned that Ellis came into a Puerto Rican song. Well, of course, Doug. He came into Hector Lavoe, a Puerto Rican salsero. Acha y Machete. You asked us, you shall receive song entrances. Speedy Ellis in the blue and yellow. Fighter from Lynn, Massachusetts. He's 15-0, 11 KOs, 23 years old. His brother Ronald is 12-0. His sister Rashida, amateur boxer. Rashidi Ellis, second time he's fighting under the Golden Boy Promotions banner, was signed after he had an impressive camp as a sparring partner for Canelo Alvarez. Canelo and his crew really liked him, told Golden Boy about him. He helped Canelo spar for the Miguel Cotto fight in November and also for the Mir Khan fight in May. Speedy Rashidi Ellis, of course, the name Speedy. You're going to see him. He is fast and he's quick with those hands.
And it's not just hand speed, but he also has a flashy showman type style. Those trunks. How do you describe those trunks? Camacho-esque?
Yeah, it's very Chop Chop Corley.
Chop Chop Corley, Sean Bay Mitchell.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mitchell used to get away. But then when you wear trunks like that, you got to be fast. You got to be flashy. And he was talking about during that interview segment some of his role models in boxing, the boxers that he looks up to. And it's guys like Melvick Taylor, Sugar Ray Leonard, Floyd Mayweather. So that's setting the bar very high, and you got to be fast, you got to be flashy, but there's got to be some substance behind that flash.
Come into the ring with sequence, you better put on a show.
Exactly.
Especially on Ring TV Live. Bethel Duran, Doug Fisher, Steve Kim, and Joseph Diaz Jr. from Indio, California. Opening round is scheduled for 8. You mentioned the open. Ellis is supposed to fight here on the 30th. Pablo Cano and Alfonso Gomez fight was scrapped, so they moved up Ellis, who said no problem. He feels in great shape. He's finally a little bit heavier, but he said no problem with it. And I remember, Steve, you were talking about him more of as a welterweight, huh?
Yeah, he really is. You know, I asked his handlers early on in the hotel if this would affect him. They said no. He actually fought a little bit at 160 as an amateur. You know, sometimes actually fighting at a higher weight, if you're not facing a King Kong or Godzilla, just the fact you don't have to cut weight will actually make the fight a little bit easier. And you look at the size of his legs, guys.
Yeah, they're thick.
He's got good pins underneath him.
Luis La Roca Hernandez, The Rock from Rio Piedras, Puerto Rico. He's 31. He's got the black and pink trunks. Only one loss on his record. That was to Eddie Gomez, Golden Boy fighter. That was back in 2012, and he took a long break between fights. He didn't come back to the ring until 2016. Didn't really want to talk about why he didn't.
Interesting. You just wonder if 2 fights in 5 rounds is enough to knock off the kind of rust that a fighter's going to accumulate over 4 years out of boxing.
Golden Boy matchmaker Roberto Diaz sat down with the Ring TV Live crew.
In
This will be Rashidi's second fight under the Golden Boy banner. He debuted under the Canelo Alvarez Amir Khan. Been out of the ring for quite some time, already in a couple camps with Canelo, so he's learned a lot. I'm excited to present Rashidi to Sugar Ray Leonard. I think Sugar Ray is gonna like Rashidi because he has, I'm not saying he's, you know, a Sugar Ray Leonard, because that, obviously that's a Hall of Famer, one of my favorite fighters of all time. But Rashidi's a very fast, technical, sound fighter who hits and doesn't get hit. Luis Hernandez, La Roca, tough, strong, aggressive. He's fought for us in the past against Eddie Gomez, went the distance. So it's gonna be fun to have, you know, Hernandez come at him and Rashidi make a miss and counter him all night and hopefully get the stoppage. But if not, like I told the team, right now the rounds, since he hasn't been as active, the rounds are important. Put those in the bank for future fights.
Joseph Diaz Jr. is the fourth man of our crew. He fights here on the 30th. Make sure you get your tickets. JoJo, what's it like fighting in an environment like Fantasy Springs?
Oh, man, it's a very great environment. The atmosphere is phenomenal. These fans are really great. They always come out and show the support for the fight fans. And I just can't wait to enter the ring and fight once again here at the Fantasy Springs July 30th and showcase my skills.
It's a little bit different, though, because you're at a casino. You fought in Vegas at a casino, but this is a different kind of casino, right? Because as soon as you're done, you walk through the crowd?
Yeah, like right after you're done, you get to walk to the crowd and take pictures with all the people, and they're all happy to see you, and they're saying that you fought very well. So it's always good to, you know, communicate with the fans right after the fight.
But in other words, you better win and put on a show.
Yeah, absolutely.
You gotta, if you don't, they're going to let you know, right?
Yeah, then they're going to start booing you and throwing water balls at you.
Nah, you don't know. Ain't nobody throwing nothing at JoJo Diaz. He fights the 30th. But when you are here at the hotel, it's different, right? Because it's a smaller venue, so everybody knows you, right?
Yeah, it's a smaller venue, and you can hear everything. You can hear everything you can hear all the people cheering you on and people that are booing and all the negativity and all the positivity.
You hear
as
that?
Well. So, yeah, you can hear everything, man, especially when you're walking into the arena, because it's a small arena, but it's a great venue. So you can hear everything that's going on.
Do you hear the announcers?
Yeah, I can hear you guys, too. So you guys better be talking good to me July 30th.
Well, do something about it then. you do put on a show, we'll put on a show. And right now, Rashidi Ellis is coming out, and he's letting his hands go a bit. Body work against Luis Gustavo Hernandez. Gustavo's the middle name on the back of his trunks. Hernandez had a 4-year break after 2012, came back to the ring June 11th this year, a 4-round decision in the Dominican Republic. Then the week after, he knocked out John Batista in the first round.
Looking pretty good for a guy with that long of a layoff. Obviously getting back in the gym, having two fights under his belt, helps. He's not cutting the ring off like Golovkin-esque style, but he is getting close enough to tag Rashidi here and there. But it was Rashidi who's in control of this fight. From a distance, he can punch on the fly, and when he's in close, he just beats Hernandez to the punch.
Well, I think halfway through round number two, Ellis is starting to really punch with his front foot now. He's actually starting to sit down and really grind to the body of Hernandez. We know he's very flashy. That's the one thing we got to see about Speedy, is when the fights get a little bit tougher, how will he hold up from a physical standpoint? Just how durable is he?
Rashidi Ellis with the distance. May 7th against Marco Lopez. Of the fighter Lopez, a tough Mexican fighter who really wasn't trying to engage at all, was more of a survival mode. Ellis got the rounds, 8 rounds. Make sure you send us your tweets using Ring TV Live. Just like Jose Vitella, who's watching at home. Agradecido, Jose, por mirándonos esta noche. And Rashidi Ellis looking good through two.
Rashidi misses with a right cross that he loaded up with, comes back with a jab, 1-2 combo. Little feint move there. not landing flush punches here, but he's still forcing Hernandez into a shell, and he actually did pierce the guard with that left uppercut and also landed with his left to the body.
Make sure to go Golden Boy Boxing's Twitter and weigh in on the poll question for tonight's main event. Who will win, Velez or Alvarado, the Boricua or Nicaragüense? Now use the hashtag RingTVLive. And we actually got some questions coming in. Uh-oh, this is for Steve Kim's News and Notes.
Okay, the question is, when will the UK know about the venue for Canelo Smith so we can book flights and hotels? I'm going to quote the great Jimmy Johnson. I'm going to give a little hint here. I heard the official announcement's going to be Monday. All I could say is, how about them Cowboys?
What does that mean?
Jerry's World.
That's a football team in Dallas, American football team. That's all I'm going to say. But official announcement will be made Monday morning, I'm told.
There you go, Steve Kim.
Hey, by the way, who shot JR?
I'm
again, no more hints. No more hints.
Remember, Steve, we're online. Our audience is very young. There's no who shot JR right. references.
You know, that's true.
That's a good point.
Jeez. How's Dirk Nowitzki doing?
There it is. How's Rashidi Ellis doing right now? He is looking good. Make sure you use that hashtag RingTV. And Texas is where Steve Rozzo lives in Houston. He's watching tonight. Appreciate Steve as always. The Martinez clan in Anaheim watching Judy Sonia. The baby, Servite High School represented there. Rashidi Ellis, trained by Alex Rivera and Edwin Diaz. Rivera actually owns a boxing gym that you see at the bottom of the trunks, the RBB for Speedy. That's the initials of the boxing gym in Lynn, where they bring kids off the streets, kids that are troublemakers or kids looking for somewhere to go, keep them off the streets, and that's how Ellis got in there. And Ellis is just looking good. The pro coming out of there. At the RBB camp, great job as the foundation. He said he considers himself a role model for the kids in that neighborhood, in that city. Smacking it with that left hand, a right from Ellis.
Yeah, Ellis is loading up more, but he's finding that Hernandez can take a really good shot. Hernandez has never been stopped, and I think this is the kind of fight that Hernandez wants. He wants Ellis to plant his feet and exchange with him.
The weigh-in. Hernandez, very animated, was on that scale, posed quickly, ran out of there quickly, didn't feel like talking to anybody. I don't blame him, I'm trying to make weight, eat as much as possible.
He's still being beat to the punch, even when Ellis is in retreat, even when Ellis is moving. But Hernandez, who makes use of his head, when they're in close, he will intentionally lean forward to bump heads. And that's something that referee Zach Young is going to have to keep an eye on. And that's also something that Ellis is going to have to keep an eye on.
A little showmanship here from the Boricua. Good action here to end of the. Come on, he's saying. Well, here it is. And we're done with three.
Guys are standing in range and trading shots. They both traded hooks. Ellis is the busier fighter, though, consistently beating Hernandez to the punch with 1-2 combinations. Hernandez connects to the body, however. Nice left to the body from Rashidi Ellis. The more Ellis stands in the pocket, the more competitive this fight is.
Fabian 562 watching on your Roku. You're watching Rashidi Ellis in the blue and Luis La Roca Hernandez in the black. Roca starting to speak more, asking for more. And Rashidi Ellis looks different in this fight, Doug, than he did when we saw him in May. In May, he was more plotting, more workmanlike. Here, he's looks crisper.
Yeah.
Looks more animated.
Yeah, definitely more animated.
This is the guy that a lot of people were telling us about, that he could put on a show, that it can look good.
Well, Beto, I think a lot of that has to do with the dance partner. Here tonight against Hernandez, he has a guy that's actually trying to put a little pressure on him. And that's the interesting thing about boxing. When a guy tries not to win in this particular sport, they could actually make it very difficult for the opponent. Now, here, one thing about Hernandez, he's very willing.
Oh, and down goes Ellis. He got caught with the left, and Hernandez is barking at him across from the ring. First time in his career that Rashidi Ellis has been on the canvas, and the Puerto Rican is jumping on him.
Hernandez is throwing with bad intentions. There's a lot of leverage behind these shots. Ellis, oh, and Ellis is going to have to hold, but he's got to watch that forehead. Hernandez has been using it as a weapon for the last two rounds.
Ellis's eyes are huge right now.
Oh, he doesn't have his legs back yet.
Well, Speedy better get on his 10 speed. He is basically buzzed and almost out on his feet.
He's looking all over the ring right now. Is Rashidi Ellis, who's down for the first time in his career. Minute 30 to go in the round. Luis Hernandez has 7 KOs in his career. He's 12-1. He's got some power behind us, Ellis just found out.
Well, he's coming off of a KO victory win, so he came into this fight believing in his power, obviously believing in his chin, and he was smart. He was able to goad Ellis into a catch-and-trade kind of fight, and Ellis not a stick-and-move type of fight.
Ellis in this round came in with his hands down, very showman-like, putting on a show, a little bit too cocky to start this round.
Well, he wanted to taunt Hernandez back, but you know what? When you taunt, keep your hands up.
31-year-old Hernandez showing some veteran savviness, dropping the 23-year-old Ellis.
And as I said at the start of this round, the more Ellis stays in the pocket, stands and tries to trade with Hernandez, the more competitive a fight we're going to be treated to.
They're willing to exchange. Hernandez, the Boricua, in the black and pink.
I'm impressed with the pressure from Hernandez, the follow-up that he's trying to impose on Ellis, and I'm impressed with Ellis's ability to survive and even fight back before the end of the round.
Final seconds of the round is scheduled for 8 between Rashidi Ellis and Luis Hernandez. That'll do it. Good round for the Boricua. Happened in the round.
Ellis lands a right hand. He's covered up at the moment.
Ooh.
It was a left, right, left hook combination that put Ellis down. He went to the body and then to the head, and he caught Ellis as Ellis was loading up with his own hook.
And in the corner of the Puerto Rican Hernandez, there was no instruction. They were trying to talk to him. Hernandez, as the DJ in the arena, DJ Ray, said his name. He let out his own woo with it. They smacked him and said, pay attention.
Yes.
Keep your hands up in this fight. And he told the corner in Spanish, lo tengo, means I have him.
Well, Beto, I think the instructions are very simple. I think there are times when fighters understand what they have to do better than any corner. I think it's just going to have to be steady pressure. And obviously the hand speed advantage goes to Ellis, but you saw what happened in that exchange with the knockdown. He's going to have to punch with Ellis and punch in between them, which is precisely what happened with that left hook.
Yeah, Don Jose Vitella, le gustó el knockdown del Boricua. Good tweet from him. Also, Linus, I know you're liking this one in Philadelphia. With that knockdown after 4, how do you have it, Doug?
I have 3-1 for Ellis, but because of the knockdown, it's just a 1-point fight, 38-37 for Rashidi Ellis.
And I have it exactly the same way. I thought the first 3 rounds were very clear for Ellis, but Mr. Hernandez got himself right back into the fight with a big 4th round, 38-37 Ellis.
The thing is, Steve, in the 3rd round, Hernandez began to get closer. I made note that the third round was competitive. And it was competitive because of a tactical choice from Ellis. He decided that he was going to plant his feet more. He wasn't going to punch on the fly. I think Ellis relished the fact that he was in with an opponent who was actually fighting him back and not just trying to survive. But he found out that Hernandez can not only take a punch, he can deliver a punch.
Fourth member of our crew, Joseph Diaz Jr., is used to knocking people down in fantasy. JoJo, when you knock somebody down here in the arena and it gets loud, what do you do?
You know what, I just try to keep my composure and stick to the game plan. The crowd gets rowdy and you want to go and try to go for the kill, but you still got to stick to the game plan, pick your shots, and land effective shots to get him out of there.
What about when you knock him down early in the round? Like, the natural instinct is just to go after him. How do you stay composed?
You know what, you got to see if the fighter's like really hurt. If the fighter's really hurt, then that's when you go after him and you finish him. But you could tell if a fighter's really hurt by the wobbliness of their legs and the jitteriness of their body.
And it looks like Rashidi Ellis got his legs back here in the fifth round. He went down in the fourth from a left from Hernandez. Two fighters, a lot of energy. And remember, Hernandez has 4.5 rounds in the last 4 years. So maybe he's working himself in there. Like you mentioned it, Doug, in the third, he was coming back with more aggressiveness. He's got that lather going now.
Yeah, he's fighting himself into shape, as the old-timers say.
Final seconds of the round. It's scheduled for 8. And what was supposed to be a matchup for Rashidi Ellis where he should have controlled, here now in a battle with Hernandez.
Los cinturones aquí se hacen a un lado. Hay que pelear por honor y por gloria nada más.
Liam's a talent. He'll fight anyone. We're going to make a big fight for him in the autumn. I think he's the biggest name in that division, and I will make sure it happens. And I believe by the end of the year, he will be the best.
Back in the Fancy Springs Resort and Casino, sixth round of action. Rashidi Ellis, Lynn, Massachusetts, in the blue trunks. He's undefeated, 15-0 with 11 KOs. Luis La Roca Hernandez, Rio Piedras, Puerto Rico, 12-1 with 7 KOs.
Ellis looks like he's back into his groove, back into that stick and move groove that he had in the first two rounds.
Let's talk from Hernandez now. He was barking up in the earlier rounds.
He needs a jab as he tries to close that distance. Sometimes he has it, sometimes he doesn't. But he also strikes me as one of those fighters where he won't let his hands go if his opponent isn't directly in front of him.
Ellis has fought 5 times in Puerto Rico, 3 times in Dominican. First time he's fighting in California. He's used to Southern California. Was at the Canelo camp in San Diego County twice. The corner of Hernandez telling him, you're not throwing.
Exactly. He can do some damage. Right now, when he gets Ellis against the ropes, he's got some nice combinations. He just walked in to a 3 or 4 punch combination from Ellis. That was Ellis living up to his nickname. That was so quick.
Now the question, Steve, conditioning factor. Hernandez has gone 4 rounds in June. He went 1 round the week later on the 18th, but before that, 4 years of inactivity. We're here in the 6th.
Yeah, and you know, if you take a look at Rashidi Ellis in 2014, he fought 10 times, only had 1 bout in 2015. Such things as the hurricane. Actually, Mother Nature got in the way of some of his fights from last year. But, you know, one thing I do notice about Al, especially this round, he's more stationary. There are opportunities here for Hernandez to let his hands go and really do some work. Right there, he needs to get his hands moving when he gets chest to chest with Ellis.
I agree. And earlier in this fight, when he was that close, he would like drop a left uppercut and left hook combination. He would work the body a little bit. He's not able to do that, or he's not willing to do that right now. That was a nice right cross from Hernandez. Oh, boy, but right now Hernandez is literally walking into 1-2 combinations from Ellis.
Trying to land a big shot of his own. Hit pay dirt in the fourth. That was it. Rashid Ellis getting his legs back underneath him. Good combination flirty in the round from Ellis.
Hernandez walking into 2 and 3 punch combinations. There's a right uppercut landed by Ellis. Left right combinations landed by Ellis, punctuated by a left hook. Ellis was definitely in his groove in round 6.
7th round of action, scheduled for 8. And Rashidi Ellis and Luis Hernandez, Bethel Duran, Doug Fisher, Steve Kim, and Joseph Diaz Jr. here ringside in Indio, California. Thanks for watching on Ring TV Live. Make sure you send us your tweets. Use that hashtag Ring TV Live, as Cheap Seats Boxing has done. And yes, I know you know about JR. Rashidi Ellis went down in the fourth. Looks like he's back in control here. And the fight, undefeated, 15-0 with 11 KOs.
As Rashidi Ellis moves up the ladder, guys, I get the sense that his knockout percentage at this point is a little bit overrated, probably more a byproduct of very favorable matchmaking. I get the sense, fast-handed guy, we see the hand speed and the quickness, doesn't really have power. And I think this is what his fights are going to look like as he moves up the rankings. He's going to have to set a quick pace early and really box from the perimeter of the rim. You don't see him with a lot of power that's able to really dissuade Hernandez on a consistent basis.
One thing about Ellis, one edge he's going to have over a lot of opponents is he is very active.
Yeah.
There's a high volume to his punching. Going to outwork a lot of guys. When you have speed and that kind of volume, you can outspeed and work your opponent. It's very hard for you to be outpointed.
Yeah, and in all fairness, as he gets hit with a good body shot there from Hernandez, having a pretty good moment now, starting to close the distance. He is fighting at 157 pounds, essentially. He really is going to settle in. So he's fighting at about 7 to 10 pounds above his optimal weight.
Yeah, and I have a feeling that Hernandez put on a lot of weight from the weigh-in.
Yeah, he ran out of that weigh-in quick. I was like,
right to the buffet.
I was like, and he was gone. He looked like Speedy getting out of that weigh-in. Speedy Ellis, some of that speed has diminished here as the rounds progressed.
Nice lead right hands from Ellis.
And right there, I don't know if you heard that in Spanish, Hernandez's corner, we're sitting right next to him, just yelled at him, you're losing this fight because you're only looking for one punch.
That's an honest cornerman. That's an honest trainer.
I don't know if he was yelling at him or he was trying to use Steve Kim's microphone. I mean, we only have 4 people on the broadcast tonight. He is looking for that. He is. He's looking for that one haymaker.
He needs to work. When he's inside, he shouldn't be looking for one big shot to the head. He should be looking to work his way up from the bottom up to the top. Work the body with both hands and then bring it up. That's how he got that knockdown. He went to the body with both hands and then switched to the head with a 1-2 combination, and he clipped Ellis as Ellis was loading up with his own shot.
Good shot from Ellis. Little flurry at the end of the round. We go to the 8th.
Really quick, want to send a rest in peace shout out.
He's fucking numb.
To the homie.
He's numb right now.
Bobby D. From Lander Shader Brown. But we're right here celebrating his life. Fantasy Springs Resort Casino, Golden Boy Boxing.
Okay, last round, we're touching gloves. I told him, if he comes in with his head like this, he'll take a point. They're both leaning on each other, but he can't come.
Hernandez had his moments in the previous round, in round seven. Landing some shots to the head. In hot pursuit of Ellis. Ellis continually outspeeds him, outworks him. This is right at the end of round seven. Nice little exchange from both guys.
Eighth and final round between Rashidi Ellis and Luis Hernandez. Hernandez dropped Ellis in the fourth round. After that, Ellis able to control, get back in control of this fight. Ellis undefeated, 15-0. Hernandez 12-1, eighth round. First time in his career that Hernandez has gone to the eighth round. Ellis listening to the instructions from his corner, his trainer, Alex Rivera, telling him you need to pick it up, throw the punches.
Needs to pick his hands up right now.
Yeah, so got him in trouble in the fourth. At the Fancy Springs Resort and Casino.
This has gone from being a showcase fight to a test for Rashidi Ellis. And he's passed it. I mean, you never know how a fighter is going to react to being knocked down or hurt in a fight until it actually happens. And Ellis has shown us, and he's shown himself, more importantly, that he can deal with it.
The co-feature next up, the main event, Jason Velez, Rene Alvarado. A little flurry from Ellis. Hernandez staying right there. Rio Piedras is where he's from.
That's where Hernandez is from?
Yes.
He is a rock.
La Roca is his name.
Yeah, he's aptly nicknamed, just like Speedy is. He can take a shot. In fact, he could take a lot of shots because he's done so in this fight. Hernandez should have been working right there, not just leaning on him. Should have been working that body.
It will be interesting to see again when Ellis starts to face a sharper, better fighter, a higher caliber, higher grade of opponent. How will he react to constant pressure? Because I get the sense the days of him knocking guys over early on in fights is probably over as he starts to get to the 10-round stage of his career.
Second time the Rashidi Ellis has gone to the eighth round. Right hand from Ellis.
I like that Ellis is trying to close the show here. He knows that he's got a lead. He has to understand that he's winning this fight. He could even give this round away if he wanted to, but he's not playing it safe.
Finish strong.
He's giving us effort, and that's important.
And he's doing this in front of the Golden Boy matchmakers and executives who are watching, who signed him last year. You only get a certain amount of fights under the promotional banner. You got to produce.
He's doing it in front of one of his heroes, Sugar Ray Leonard.
Yes, he is. Final seconds of the fight. Roll the push down from Hernandez, and that'll do it. They go the distance. Rashidi Ellis knocked down in the fourth, comes back to control the fight. We'll be back with the decision from the judges. You're watching Ring TV Live from Indio, California.
Los cinturones aquí se hacen a un lado. Hay que pelear por honor y por gloria nada más.
Liam's a talent. He'll fight anyone. We're going to make a big fight for him in the autumn. I think he's the biggest name in that division, and I will make sure it happens. And I believe by the end of the year, he will be the best.
With the left by Orozco, and it is over. a first round stoppage for Antonio Relentless Orozco.
Chucho Diaz Jr.
A representative came to my school talking about the different programs and information security was one. Family, friends, but the best part about graduation day was when I got to announce to my family that I had gotten the job. For some, school is a backup plan, but for me, it was the only plan. And I ended up choosing ITT Tech over other four-year institutions.
Scholarships and financial aid are available for students who qualify. Call 800-227-2162. That's 800-227-2162.
Fine fans, after eight rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. Y todos de los señores anotaron el mismo 78, 73. All three have it, 78, 73. El ganador por decisión unánime, your winner by unanimous decision, and still undefeated, Speedy Rashidi.
From Lynn, Massachusetts, he stays undefeated. Speedy Rashidi Ellis survives a fourth down knockdown to get the victory. How'd you have it, Doug?
I had it just like the official judges, which means the only round they scored for Hernandez was round four, which was a 10-8 round.
As did I, Doug, 78-73. I thought it was an easy call, and I think Rashidi Ellis and his management realized one thing. They certainly are much more of a welterweight than junior middleweight, and you wonder as you look ahead, take a look at some of the good young welterweights in the world. Errol Spence, I think, unanimously is considered the best young 47-pounder. Another kid that I like fights tomorrow, actually, in Lancaster, California. Igis Kavalishkis, the mean machine. Then you have Konstantin Pomeranov. Based on tonight, you wonder, where does Rashidi Ellis fit in?
That was a good co-main event. The main event, of course, coming up, Jason Velez against Rene Alvarado. Our Twitter poll has been hot all night long. Let's see how they have it. The precincts are reporting. Alvarado, Nicaragua coming strong.
That's a bit of a surprise.
They've seen him here a lot at Fantasy Springs. Jason Velez coming off a loss to Joseph Diaz. And you can still continue to go there. Golden Boy Boxing Twitter will get those results going up until the first punch is thrown. And that's coming up next for our main event. Rashidi Ellis is making his way over towards our desk here in the blue corner. And we're going to be joined by the native of Lynn, Massachusetts. There you go, Rashidi. There you go. Take a breath. I'll ask a question.
Yeah.
Breathe a little bit.
I'm good.
You good?
Yeah, I'm good.
All right, I'm going to come strong. What happened in that fourth round?
I don't know. He just coming with a lucky one. You know, that happens in boxing. But, you know, I had to come back strong.
How did you able to recuperate in that round?
I just say, figure it is what it is. Like,
yeah.
It's me and him.
It happened early enough in the round, yeah, where if you weren't able to regain your bearings or survive or fight back, then most, yeah, people would have thought he had enough time to stop you.
Yeah.
But how soon were you able to collect your own wits and realize, I'm going to get out of this round and I'm going to get back to the game plan?
I don't know. It was like a good 10 seconds. I ain't going to lie. He caught me with a good one. You know, my legs felt a little wobble, but, you know, I got my back. You know, just boxed a little bit and then I came right back.
This weight, how did you feel at it? It's not your natural weight.
Oh, this ain't my weight class, yeah, at all. Nah. I felt heavy in there, you know, but no excuses, you know.
How heavy did he feel, though? Did you feel his weight? Look, he looked heavier than you. Did you feel his weight or his
kind
physical
of,
strength,
no,
when he was on top of you?
I look good right
there. Yeah, you look good right there. Here's early on in the fight, some highlights. What do you see right here from yourself, Rashidi?
Oh, I was picking my head up. Nah, okay. That's what you're coming with?
Nah, it's just a montage of everything. So whatever you see, go for it.
Ooh.
That's the one.
Yeah, he caught me. He caught me.
Here's another angle.
But I can see I lift my head up. I picked up with the hook. Yep, right there. Motherfucker. So you see my leverage.
No, we know those words.
You're excusing this. Yeah. I'm sure that's exactly what you were thinking.
Yeah. But yeah.
But you came back
though,
and you fought hard.
Yeah.
When you come back, when you have to go through that adversity, How deep do you have to dig to get this control, this fight back?
Well, this is my first time, but, you know, I had to dig deep. You know, I had to just suck it up. It is what it is, like I said, you know?
How much did sparring against Canelo for two camps prepare you for this?
Oh, truth is, that was like the last time I really sparred, you know. But,
oh, really?
Yeah, but I sparred a little bit. I sparred only like once or twice, but, you know. I still did good.
Rashidi Ellis, Lynn, Massachusetts, right?
Yeah, Lynn.
I know they claim Boston. You had that Celtics hat on, but Lynn, Massachusetts. There's that camera. Send your shout-outs, man.
Oh, where is that? Oh, the little one right here?
Yeah, that's the little one.
Yeah, just follow me at Rashidi Ellis.
There it is. RBB Boxing out of the Lynn, Massachusetts. We'll be back with more on Ring TV Live. Actually, no. We're coming back with the main event. Rashidi, go to the commission. They're coming to get you, boy.
Hey, congratulations again.
There's the Boricua, Jason Velez, coming through to the ring. And Ring TV Live caught up with Jason Velez.
Jason, La Maravilla Velez.
You know, first of all, at this level, every guy is tough guy. I learned I needed to move up in weight, you know. I was good, but I wasn't great. I came back with my first trainer, the trainer that taught me how to fight. I'm boxing more again, like I was doing when I started to fight. So using more my jab, more movement, not go face to face every time. You know, you could expect from me a great fight as always. More speed, more power, better stamina. You will see me different, moving more, being more intelligent. You will see the Jason that you used to know. I feel I have to win. I need to win. I have lost two fights in a row. So I can lose three fights in a row. So I have to fight. I have to win this fight. I will win. I need to win. So I've been working for no more than win. I just want to win because I need it.
Ringside, Eddie Hernandez, Fritz Werner, and Zach Young. Encargado de ring, el referee de Bassett, California, Ray Corona. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the judges are ready and the fighters are ready. Indio, make some noise if you are ready! Presentando primero la esquina azul, con los pantaloncillos azul con blanco y un peso de 129 libras y medias. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing white, trimmed in blue, he weighed in officially 129 and 1.5 pounds. Un veterano de 30 peleas, su record 23 victorias, con 16 ganadas por nocaut. Y siete derrotas, this 35 veteran has a record that stands at 23 victories, 7 defeats, 16 big wins coming by way of knockout de Managua, Nicaragua. Here is the former WBC International Silver Super Featherweight Champion, El Gemelo, René Alvarado. Y sorprende en la esquina roja, con los pantaloncillos negro con amarillo y un peso de 130 libras. His opponent across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wears black, trimmed in yellow. He weighed officially 130 pounds even. Su récord excelente con 23 victorias, solamente 2 derrotas, un empate y 16 ganadas por nocaut. His professional record in 26 bouts, 23 victories. 2 defeats, 1 draw, 16 wins by way of knockout. Presentando el Boricua de Juncos, Puerto Rico, Jason La Maravilla Velez. Once again, referee Ray Corona with the final instruction.
Here's good, aquí está bien. Escúchame, touch gloves, God bless.
They don't speak English, neither one.
Bassett, California, the referee, the tell of the tape, Doug Fisher.
Alvarado, 1 year younger at age 27. Velez, 1.5 inches taller, and Alvarado has a very slight reach advantage.
We get ready to go. Jason Velez, El Boricua. He came into Victor Manuel. Daría mi vida por ella. Give my life for her. He's in the ring right now. 10 rounds, super featherweight action against René El Gemelo Alvarado. The common opponent, 2012 Olympian and undefeated rising prospect Joseph Diaz Jr., the fourth member of our crew. And JoJo, who gave you a tougher fight?
You know what? I think René Alvarado gave me the tougher fight. The reason being is because he was very aggressive, throwing a lot of punches and bunches. But I think the advantage will go to Jason Velez. Jason Velez is a longer fighter and a rangier fighter, so if he's going to be able to outbox René Alvarado, he'll pull out the victory tonight.
Yeah, you fought Jason Velez decision 10 rounds in March, and then you took on Alvarado last June. That was in the sports arena, the house that Benoit Benjamin built. And when you see these two guys in this ring right now, and don't give me that, oh, it's going to be a tough fight, it's going to be a brawl. Right now, who do you think has the advantage?
I personally think Jason Velez. The reason is because he seems like he's hungry. He's determined. He just lost two fights in a row, and I know that he wants to bounce back and become a world title contender once again. So I think the advantage is Jason Velez, no doubt.
Joseph Diaz will be jumping in with commentary all throughout the night, and you're right. Two losses back-to-back for Jason Velez. He was undefeated 23-0 with one draw. Then he lost to Ronnie Rios on the Canelo Cotto undercard. That went 12 rounds for the WBC silver belt. Then he lost to Joseph 10 rounds in a fight that Joseph controlled. Meanwhile, René Alvarado, last time he was in the ring at the Belasco Theater against Tino Avila, they went the distance, a fight that left many asking more for growth fighters. But Tino came away with a decision. And before that, here at in Fantasy Springs, Andrew Chango Cancio stopped him in the seventh round. And that was a fight where Alvarado looked good.
Well, not only that, he seemed to be taking over in the early part of that fight. And based on that victory, Andrew Cancio is actually able to earn a promotional deal with Top Rank. Beto, one note here. Gary Grant and Marcus Johnson are very upset by your earlier reference. But in regards to Joseph Diaz, talking to his manager, Ralph Heredia, if he should come out clean July 30th here in this venue, goal is to get on the September 17th Canelo undercard, and they said if he had his way by the end of the year or beginning of 2017, they would like to get a shot at Gary Russell Jr. They are number two in the WBC.
But first, JoJo has to get through July 30th. Tickets on sale here at the Fantasy Springs Resort and Casino. That'll be on HBO Latino. Ring TV live cameras will be here also for you. This is the opening round, scheduled for 10. René Alvarado from Managua, Nicaragua in the white trunks. Jason La Maravilla Velez in the black trunks.
I think Velez is boxing in a very controlled manner. This is the most elusive and sharp I've seen Velez since his prospect days out of Puerto Rico.
10 seconds to go in the opening round between Velez and Alvarado. A crossroads fight for both of these fighters, and matchmaker Roberto Diaz on this matchup.
Definitely a crossroad fight at this point in their careers. Renato's always been in very good fights here in the U.S. Had a very good fight with Manuel Avila. Surprisingly got knocked out by Andrew Cancio, which was a great job on Andrew Cancio's part. But bottom line, he's always in the fight. He's always a tough opponent. Jason Velez is coming off the loss with Joseph Diaz. Tells me he learned a lot from that fight. So it's basically sink or swim. You know, it's one of those fights that the winner can move on to bigger and better things. And the loser, it's not the end of his career, but he has to really step back and say, okay, do I want to continue this path as just an opponent, or do I want to go sharpen my tools and come back later?
Golden Boy matchmaker Roberto Diaz rolls in big company. There you see JoJo's manager Ralph Heredia and Sugar Ray Leonard, who was here signing autographs, played golf with Oscar yesterday. Always cool to see the legend here at Fantasy Springs. Second round of action, Ms. Fight Lady. Thank you for watching on Ring TV Live. Also, Cynthia, the UCLA product, San Diego State alum, and watching her fellow countryman, René Alvarado, the Nicaragua, and of course, she's eating gallo pinto, the native food of Nicaragua. rooting for him. And, you know, Steve, also, you mentioned Nicaragua, some fighters out of that country.
Roman Gonzalez.
Fighting?
Alexis Arguello. Rosendo Alvarez.
Ricardo Mayorga.
I just love setting you guys up for history lessons. Alexis Arguello, right?
And again, you're right. Roman Gonzalez, again, September 10th at the Forum, will be taking on Carlos Cuadras. He's trying to make some history, Doug, becoming, I believe, the first Nicaraguan to win four championships in four different weight classes.
Yes.
Arguello got stopped in that attempt against Aaron Pryor at the Orange Bowl.
It's an epic encounter.
Jason?
1982.
Yeah, what a fight. Oof.
Orange Bowl. What a venue.
No longer with us, Beto. Hmm.
Jason Velez started boxing at the age of 11. First fight he remembers watching as a kid, Oscar against Tito. Said after that, hooked on the sport of boxing. Has fought at Madison Square Garden, has fought in Las Vegas. He's trying to stay as a name in his division after two losses. Meanwhile, Rene Gemelo Alvarado, Gemelo being twin, is a fighter who is 0-5 in the United States. Could he be relegated to a gatekeeper status?
If he loses this fight, that's how he will be viewed. He's viewed with a lot of respect from hardcore fans who've seen him fight because they realize the level of his opposition. They realize that he's been in there with young talents like Joseph Diaz Jr. and Eric Hunter, who's marvelously talented out of Philadelphia. And, of course, that fight that he had with Canseco is one of the underrated ring battles of 2015. That was a hell of a fight.
And, Doug, he also fell victim to the last stand of Rocky Juarez in Texas, which was a very good pitched battle a couple years ago.
Alvarado in the white, Velez in the black. Two fighters filling each other out. Main event in Indio, California, where it was 115 degrees today in the shade. Nothing wrong with that. No reason for anybody to miss weight.
No excuses. We should note these guys are fighting the scheduled 10-round bout in the super featherweight or junior lightweight division. That means they got to weigh in at 130 pounds. They're used to fighting at featherweight, 126 pounds.
Final seconds of the second round. It's scheduled for 10. Bethel Duran, Doug Fisher, Steve Kim. Keep using the hashtag RingTVLive.
Necesito que mantenga la mano izquierda arriba y cuando tire, mueve para los lados.
Keep your left hand up.
Con la derecha por encima. Okay. Mantenga y esa derecha, tira la recta. Tira la recta por la
pierna. Keep using your jab, throw that right.
Tira la recta, vaya.
Okay. That's all. Jose Parrilla is the trainer for Jason Velez, the Twitter poll. Oh, like a couple late precincts.
Yeah. Velez has changed a few minds with these first two rounds of this fight. Although I have it one round apiece. I thought Alvarado got closer in round two and just edged it with his pressure. But I can certainly see scoring both the first and the second round for Velez. He's boxing very well.
Third round of action, Jason Velez. You mentioned it, Doug, before the end of that round, they're fighting at 130 pounds. He was 0.8 over. Alvarado's corner insisted on him getting down to 130. Needed four tries in the two-hour break to get down exactly at 130. Went outside for a little bit, covered up, came back, he lost 0.4 ounces. Went outside again, got the gum, was spitting for at least 10 minutes. We were in that weigh-in trying to find gum for him. Lost 0.2 ounces. Finally stripped down and got to the 130 and the 2 hours allotted. Because if you don't come in at the weight, you have to pay the commission fines.
It'll be interesting to see if that struggle to make 130 pounds affects him midway or down the stretch of a tough fight. And that would behoove Alvarado to set a torrid pace and to put as much pressure on Velez as he possibly can muster.
Alvarado got on the scale 130 on the dot immediately.
Beto, you talk about the struggles to make weight and get those last precious few ounces off. I've known of fighters that actually do what I call the hotel sauna. We basically go into the bathroom, stick towels underneath the door, and put the shower on hot as you can and just let the steam rise and you create your own sauna. Fighters do a lot of different things in the lead up to try to make that weight.
Yeah, well, this one, Alvarado's corner and Alvarado himself waited in the lounge. Alvarado didn't even go eat or anything. He waited in that lounge where they did the weigh-ins and just looked at him. And you can see Velez's trainer's like, come on, point two, we're really going to argue over this? But these are world-class athletes. If you force them to struggle for an extra 20 minutes, it also makes a mind game with them.
Yeah.
Velez in the black, less than a minute to go in the third round.
Oh, it's you're absolutely right. It is a psych game, and it's Alvarado's corner, and Alvarado's in the blue corner, which is kind of like the opponent corner.
Oh, yeah.
It's letting them know, hey, we don't view ourselves. We don't view you as the A side, and we're the B side, and you can get away with stuff.
Well, they're both Golden Boy fighters.
Right.
And I asked Roberto, why is Velez the A side fighter? Because Velez only has two losses,
right,
and he's been in bigger profile fighters as of late.
And he did fight for a world title against Evgeny Gradovich 2 years ago, and he didn't lose that fight. It was a draw.
He ruled a draw. Alvarado lands a solid right. Another wild swing and a miss. Velez moving around nicely in that ring. Final seconds of the third round. It is scheduled for 10 in Indio, California. Velez and Alvarado. Night, July 30th, Saturday night in Indio. Get your tickets. It'll be a good one. Antonio Roscoe, the main event. Joseph Diaz, the co-feature. HBO Latino card. Ring TV will be here starting at $25. Already a good ticket pace. Ready to go. The night before, Earth, Wind, and Fire, fellas. Oh, yeah, we're here.
Hey. Doesn't get any better than that.
Exactly. Don't get better than Ring TV on your tube on a Saturday night as Rene Alvarado in the white trunks. Jason Velez started boxing at the age of 11 because they were looking for a karate gym. His dad wanted to get him into some sort of martial arts to have his son protect himself. He grew up in Yuncos, Puerto Rico. They were looking for a karate gym. They walked into a boxing gym, not knowing that it was a boxing gym, so they took a couple lessons. They're wondering, when do we start kicking? No. Boxing, they realized his hands were quick, and he never left that boxing gym. Now a professional.
Ooh, he is getting tagged a lot round, Velez is, particularly by the right hand of Alvarado. And Alvarado, as aggressive as he's been deceptively crafty. He is blocking and evading a lot of shots that Velez throws his way. I hope the judges are taking notice.
I think he's applied steady pressure, and for most of the night as he lands another right-handed and uppercut, he's been the guy forcing the action. For the most part, Velez has been boxing off his back foot, and quite frankly, don't know really how effective he is in terms of actually winning these early rounds.
Yeah, I've only scored the first round for Velez, but it was very close. Rounds two and three, I scored for Alvarado. So I have Alvarado ahead by 1 point, and he's, in my view, taking command of this fight here in round four.
Doug, I agree, and I have a shutout, 30-27. I thought round one could have gone either way, but I voted for the aggression of Alvarado, who's having another good frame here in the fourth.
And continue voting at Golden Boy Boxing's Twitter account. Use hashtag RingTVLive. Voting from Durango, Mexico, Veronica, La Tierra de los Alacranes. She likes Alvarado right now. Continue to vote. We'll put up the poll later on in this fight. Alvarado in the white. swinging a wild miss, and he is trying to land that haymaker. Since the opening round, he's been
throwing
that.
One thing about Velez, he's always shown a very reliable chin. He's not somebody we've seen hurt or down. He's never been stopped in his career, but you wonder if that struggle to make weight that you spoke of, Beto, is affecting him and also affecting his punch resistance.
From Juncos, Puerto Rico, is Jason Velez, home of Juan Manuel Lopez. On the eastern side of the island.
Velez might have to go back to his more recent form. He started out as a pure boxer, but in recent fights, in recent years, he's been more of a volume puncher, yeah. Somebody who stands in the pocket. He might have to do that. Rene Alvarado taking over this fight in the fourth round, working Velez over with body shots and right crosses to the head, steadily backing Velez up to the ropes and outworking him.
Fifth round of action, scheduled for 10. Say that there's been a flurry of punches would be an overstatement. This is a grinded out fight for two guys with a lot on the line.
Usually when you say it's a grinding out fight, that is a benefit to Alvarado because that is his fight. He beats guys on tenacity and conditioning. But he's also showing some nice craft here tonight.
No, and Beto, I will note that the majority of hard, clean punches that have been landed throughout the first 4 minutes and four rounds and change have been landed by the Nicaraguan.
Flash of heads.
Accidental. I don't see any abrasions or blood.
Brunez corner telling him, be first, be first. We're sitting right next to us. You'll hear them leading into your sound. Body work from Velez. Remember Jason Velez used to just come out and put on a quick show when we see him at the Velasco early on. Then he fought Ronnie Rios, and that was a fight where Ronnie was the B-side opponent from Santa Ana, California.
Right.
And Ronnie, with that win, got himself back into the mix in the division because Ronnie had a big loss here against Robinson Castellanos where he was stopped by Castellanos, Robin Hood from Guanajuato. And Alvarado lands a good right, snaps back the head of Velez. Castellanos is a fighter that Rene Alvarado beat in 2014, knocked him out in the ninth round.
That pushed him way up the WBC's featherweight rankings at the time. He was so close to getting a title shot, and then he lost. He lost to Rocky Juarez and suffered other losses, and he can taste it. He's just 27 years old. He wants to get back in that position, and that's why he's fighting so hard. But Velez is fighting hard because you can't lose three fights in a row and consider yourself a contender.
And
you know,
Doug, you see Velez trying to step inside the pocket and stand and deliver. But right now, I think that's exactly where Alvarado would love this fight to be for the rest of the night.
He's comfortable like that.
Right. He's actually out-punching Velez right at this distance. He's much more comfortable inside the pocket.
The Boo Birds are starting to come out here. They had a good opening bout. It's the sixth and final fight of the night. This is when you go deep into your notes. Beto Duran, Rene Alvarado from Managua, the capital city in Nicaragua. The Nahuatl language means adjacent to water. They call themselves Managuenses or Capitalinos. Dennis Martinez Stadium is in Managua. That's where we're reaching right now. So these guys need to pick into that action. But there's a lot on the line for both of these fighters.
I think they're giving. I think the folks who were booing just maybe they need to drink some more Tecate because I think they're giving us some good exchanges in here. There's an effort from both fighters.
Oh, without a doubt.
Alvarado is just getting the better of Velez.
Time.
Alvarado Velez, Joseph Diaz Jr. knows him well. JoJo, little flashbacks here. And we'll come back with JoJo. Yeah, that's right, JoJo. Keep that face, man. You got good hair, though. You got good hair, bro. Good tie. We'll get that mic ready to go. We're getting ready for the sixth round. It's scheduled for 10. Meta World Peace is here. Laker, or actually, no, free agent NBA player. Big boxing fan. He saw a fighter that he's helping in his career, John Leon, at a first-round KO. Also, Mauricio Herrera, El Maestro, is in attendance, as is Diego De La Hoya.
And Alvarado getting the better of Velez on the inside. A moment ago, he landed an uppercut, and there it is. He's leaning to his left and trying to come up with the left. Also working the right side. Both fighters giving a tremendous effort so far.
A good effort. Not much action, but there's a good effort from both of them, which is what you expect from two quality professionals. And Jason Velez at the age of 28, Rene Alvarado, 27. Sixth round. Jason La Maravilla Velez. The one thing he learned after that fight with Ronnie Rios, that he needed to train harder. Gradovich taught him he needed to train better and smarter. Joseph Diaz Jr., these guys look familiar to you? Deja vu a little bit, the grinded out style?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, Rene Alvarado's taking it to Jason Velez right now. I feel like he's being more aggressive, and I feel like Jason Velez shouldn't be fighting this fight. He should be fighting on the outside and keeping his distance and landing the effective shots on the outside. But now he's fighting Rene Alvarado's fight. Then Rene Alvarado, he throws a lot of punches on the inside, very short, and he's being effective with it, and he's winning the fight so far.
Right by Velez. Now, you fought Alvarado. This was the type of fight that you had with him, right?
Yes, this was the type of fight that me and Rene Alvarado fought. And I knew that if I tried to box him, because I knew that he was longer than me, then I'd be getting caught on the outside. So yeah. I needed to bang on the inside with him and land effective shots.
And what about Velez?
With Velez, he can't be fighting like this because he's taller and longer than me. He has a longer reach, and he's very taller than me. So he should be boxing this guy. He shouldn't be banging on this side, because when he does try to land effective shots on the inside, Rene Alvarado's just countering him and landing the shorter shots.
This isn't the Jason Velez you knew when you were coming up, huh?
No, actually,
he looks different, right?
Yes, he does, man. His conditioning seems like it's not there, and he seems like he's not as powerful as he once was.
Yeah, because remember at Belasco, I think you were on the undercard of one of his shows at Belasco, where he came in and he was like a flurry.
Yeah, and
got
he was all
buzzing.
And he had he was very energetic. He was all dancing around and being very strong and throwing a lot of combinations. And today, man, you don't see him fighting on the outside or landing effective combinations. He's getting tired, and you can tell.
Yeah, you can really see it in his body language. He is being systematically and gradually broken down by Alvarado.
Well, on the inside, his head looks like a tetherball. I mean, he's getting hit with some very quick combinations. We saw about a minute ago, his legs are really starting to fade.
And that used to be one of the things that Velez was known for, his conditioning, able to look good. Body was cut and ripped. This guy's hunched over right now. Alvarado coming on fresh. Shot landed. But Velez will throw one, absorb that. Not many combinations coming from the Boricua, where Alvarado starting to pick up the pace a little bit more here in the final seconds. We have you trained for 12 rounds. You're conditioned for 12 rounds. I think that's what he said. Don't let him. Hit him. A different accent than Nicaraguas.
Velez got in a sweeping left hook, tried to follow it with a right to the head, kind of just grazed him with it, but it's Alvarado who's backing Velez up. 1-2 attack, and there's attacking the body with both hands, coming up to the head with a left hook.
La Puerta Negra was jamming between rounds. Los Tigres del Norte in the crowd going here. Rene Alvarado, El Gemelo in the white trunks. How do you guys have it after six, Doug?
I have a one-sided fight. I have it 59-55 for Rene Alvarado. I haven't scored a round for Velez since the opening round.
And Doug, I'm like you for the most part, except the first round you gave it to Velez. I gave it to Alvarado based on aggression, and I think that aggression has only grown. And I think now Jason Velez boxing, Beto, I think has become a full-blown retreat.
Survival?
In many ways, many respects, absolutely. If you look at Velez, you look at his body language, you look at the legs, they don't seem to be there, and there's not a lot on those punches. Velez has never been a hard, authoritative puncher, but right now there's almost nothing on it. It looks like a wet shoelace, and Alvarado gets the sense he could probably walk through anything that comes his way.
Throwing that heavy left, and when Jason Velez, Joseph Diaz Jr. was announced, it was like, oh, yeah. Step up for JoJo here. How much damage does JoJo do that Velez looks like this his next fight?
Well, JoJo does do a lot of damage.
Right.
With the way he goes to the body, he doesn't have one-punch knockout power, but he has pretty heavy hands for a young man.
The one thing that I would describe Joseph Diaz is sharp and accurate, and he chips away at you like an axe. He's not like a buzzsaw that's going to go right through you and stop you, but you're usually going to get punished for 10 rounds. That's exactly what happened. If you look at Velez, he's had a lot of tough fights since late 2014 against Gradovic.
Yep,
and then we take a look
fight.
At Ronnie Rios, who ground up his body in the second half, and you see the residual effect tonight against Alvarado.
Seventh round, it's scheduled for 10. Less than a minute to go in the seventh round. And We saw him against Daniel Rodriguez, Tijuana fighter at Velasco. Did we see Velez?
Yes.
The kid named Huracan, a kid who actually helps build the rings.
Yeah, we see him there all the time, just not in boxing trunks.
Now, I'm coming back to this, and Velez was tagged some in that fight.
He was. It was.
He won the fight, but he was tagged.
Yeah.
And the next fight was Ronnie
Rios.
And
he loved it. Velez welcomed it. He had a lot of confidence going into that fight. It was just a stay busy fight. That was the fight that Joseph Diaz Jr. alluded to, where he was dancing between rounds rather than sit down. He had so much energy. And he outclassed and outworked and outboxed Daniel. He does not look like the same fighter tonight.
I was at 128, 130 tonight, the heaviest he's ever been. And he does not look like the Jason Velez that we're used to.
Velez trying to get some work done on the inside. Does land a left and then a right cross to the ear. There's more grappling right here than clean punches landed by either fighter. There the Alvarado actually starts to unload and land some clean shots.
Our security blanket in Philadelphia, Linus, skipped a soccer game, and he has a great tweet. Middle round sag from Velez, just like he did against Ronnie Rios.
Yeah. That was actually a very competitive fight for the first six, seven rounds, and I thought in rounds 8, 9, and 10, Ronnie Rios made a decision to go against his own identity and step inside and get inside the chest of Velez, and really, I thought, ground him up to the body, and I thought, pulled away late.
That's a great point. A lot of fights coming your way from Ring TV Live.
July 30th, we're back here in Indio for Antonio Orozco, the relentless one. Managed by Frank Espinoza, undefeated. And then Joseph Diaz Jr. is the co-feature on that bout. Nick Arce, Westside Boxer, will be on there also. Then August 5th, get your tickets now. Belasco Theater, LA Fight Club, the first Friday of the month. Always sells out. Great time. They put the ring on the dance floor. A show. And also August 19th, back at Belasco. So two shows in August for you in Southern California. A lot of the hot prospects coming your way, you're going to be seeing in action. And then in September, Canelo will be fighting somewhere in the Midwest, according to Steve Kim.
Or Southwest.
Or Southwest. Or in the SEC country.
Howdy. That's all I'm going to say.
Yep. SMU is around there. According to Steve Kim, nothing been reported, but Steve Kim's news and notes, never wrong. If you listen to the Three Knockdown podcast with Mario Lopez, the Montoya Factor podcast is always good. And you've been doing a video series where Montoya believes in medium shirts. Yeah. And the Doug's mailbag every Friday and Monday. The email for that, Dougie, is?
Dougie@boxingmailbag.com.
What's been the theme lately?
Golovkin Brook. And surprisingly, there's just as much of a positive reaction as there is a negative reaction.
Really?
There's not a few. There aren't a lot of neutral fans on that particular matchup. They either are excited and hyped about it, or they're disgusted by it.
It's like Donald Trump. You either hate it or you love it. There's no in between.
That's boxing.
there's a lot of excitement. Political views of Steve Kim.
There's a lot of excitement for Gonzalez Quadras.
Yep.
As well. Of course, next week we have Terrence Crawford versus Victor Postol, and that'll be for the Ring Magazine Junior Welterweight Championship.
Well, that's for the Ring one.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Well, it's the number one and number two contender at 140 pounds.
Needless to note, the jam is too loud. I couldn't hear that, or else I would have translated.
Right uppercut from Alvarado. Tries to go to the body with his left. Brings it up, kind of cuffing behind the head. Connects with the right uppercut. These guys are throwing on the inside, but they're also blocking a lot. There was a decent right to the body from Velez. He is still trying. Just appears listless.
No, he does. That's the thing. The guy that had more snap, more torque on his punches throughout the night has been Alvarado.
Although I see some fatigue from Alvarado as well.
Alvarado, his last fight, he went the distance with Tino Avila in 10 rounds. And Tino Avila, the Golden Boy fighter from Northern California, coming off a victory last weekend in a stay busy fight for him.
As I recall that Alvarado fight, Alvarado had a slow start because of a shoe malfunction. The soles of his shoes were worn out. He had these Asics, these wrestling shoes on, and he was slipping and sliding. And they finally taped up his shoes. He was able to get a little more traction, make a little bit more of a fight of it.
Okay, he's wearing Everlast tonight, so Ernie found him.
Those are working for him.
Both fighters with Everlast boots.
Both shoes look very comfortable.
Ninth round, it's scheduled for 10. You hear the clapping. That's not a fan. That's Alvarado's corner telling him to step it up a little bit.
They don't want him to coast.
No, and both of these fighters are Golden Boy fighters towards the end of their promotional contracts.
I think in wrestling they'd call that loser leaves town, Beto. You get the sense in a certain way this is a Golden Boy eliminator. I think the winner is still useful. The loser, well, as they say, the Turk says, coach wants to see you bring your playbook.
The Turk. Can't wait for Hard Knocks to come back.
Hard Knocks coming back in a couple weeks, Beto. Always a summer ritual.
Coming back is HBO Latino and Ring TV Live to Indios July 30th. Beto Duran, Doug Fisher, Steve Kim, Joseph Diaz Jr. He's got a microphone in his hand. Be jumping in with him next round. Get his impressions of that. He'll be fighting here on the 30th.
I get the sense that this has just been a frustrating night for Velez, who seems kind of lost in terms of what boxing style he wanted to try to employ tonight. Didn't stick with the stick and move.
You know,
can't
Doug,
really hang in there with the inside grind.
You know, sometimes when a fighter doesn't make weight, it really doesn't mean much. It means they've misgauged the weight at the end. Sometimes it's very indicative of a bad training camp, and we don't know what may have led up to the previous 6 to 8 weeks to tonight. He just looks very, very listless.
Flat.
The physical
performance, yeah.
Almost like a puppet with the strings cut off, to be honest.
And this is
you.
At a heavier weight that he's yeah. accustomed to. So imagine if he was trying to cut down to 28. Yeah. 10 seconds to go in the ninth round. It's scheduled for 10. Indio, California, on a night where the Gemelo Nicaragüense, Rene Alvarado, is cruising through 9.
Inside work from these junior lightweights. Salvarado landing the clean shots, mainly his right hand. Even as he backs up, misses right there as they stumble over their legs. I think Alvarado stepped on the foot of Velez.
Joseph Diaz Jr., how do you have it? Okay. I agree. There's nothing to be said about that, Joseph. As Rene Alvarado is looking to celebrate after this round. He's cruising.
Yeah, I think Alvarado has been cruising the last couple of rounds.
JoJo, you've been watching this one, 10th and final round. Tell me you got Alvarado winning this.
Oh, absolutely. I got Alvarado winning decisively. I mean, he's just being aggressive, landing the effective shots on the inside, and it just seems like Velez is just out of it, man. He looks tired, he looks drained, and he don't have anything on the shots.
Left shot by Alvarado. If you were in the ring right now and you're Alvarado, what would you be doing right now?
If I was in the ring and if I was Alvarado, I would just be doing exactly what I'm doing the whole entire fight. I mean, he's being aggressive.
But did you go for the kill?
I don't know about going for the kill because that you know what? You don't want to.
Come on, man. The broadcasters need a kill. Sounds good. We want to get you the highlights.
Yeah, I know, but he don't want to get caught with anything because Jason
gotcha.
Velez, he's still a very powerful guy, man. He still hits hard, so if he gets caught, then he might get hurt.
That's something you're really aware of, then, huh?
Yeah, exactly.
Your fight's July 30th. After that, you come away with everything. What's the plan for you the rest of this year?
You know what? If everything goes well July 30th and I don't get no cuts or no injuries, I'm looking to fight again in September. Hopefully get a guy that's ranked number 2 in the WBC or something, and then fight for a world title by the end of this year.
Joseph Diaz Jr., what's your Twitter?
My Twitter is @JosephDiazJr., and my Instagram is Joseph Diaz Jr. as well.
You got a Snapchat or is that private?
Snapchat is Joseph Diaz with 2 Z's. Follow me, guys.
2 Z's? Oh,
two
my
Z's.
Goodness. You're a multi-platform. You're not playing Pokemon either because you're working this fight with us. A minute to go in the 10th and final round. Great job tonight, JoJo. We'll see you on the 30th. Rene Alvarado is fighting essentially for his American career. He's 0-5 in the United States, 7 losses total. He's gone up against some of the bigger names in the division. He's been a quasi
gatekeeper without knowing it.
Right.
Rocky Juarez, JoJo, Andrew Cancio, Tino Avila. And tonight against a fighter with only two losses, Jason Velez, a big fighter out of Puerto Rico. He has been looking good since the opening bout with 25 seconds to go in that fight.
Well, he certainly hasn't gone into the four corners. I have him up big, as does Doug, and I think he's put the finishing touches on what's been a very solid night's work against Jason Velez.
Yeah, he's outworked Velez in this 10th and final round, and he's also snapped that head back a lot. He's landed some serious leather.
Alvarado has been wanting a Toña beer, maybe some Flor de Caña, the way he's been putting on the show tonight. Alvarado, Velez, they go the distance, and Alvarado, the Nicaraguan, lets out a big scream. And he looked good tonight. We'll be back with the decision from Indio. You're watching Ring TV Live.
Los cinturones aquí se hacen a un lado. Hay que pelear por honor y por gloria nada más.
Liam's a talent. He'll fight anyone. We're going to make a big fight for him in the autumn. I think he's the biggest name in that division, and I will make sure it happens. And I believe by the end of the year, he will be the best.
Representative came to my school Warner, talking about the different programs and information security was won.
Dividida, your winner by split decision, El Gemelo, Rene Alvarado.
Like admitting the defeat, but yeah. Split decision?
He knows he lost. There's no way you could have scored that fight for Velez. I had it 99-91 for Alvarado.
We had two 96-94s. It was 96-94 to 97-93.
I guess we all see different things. I had it 100-90. I thought it was an easy call for that man right there from Nicaragua.
This is why we're in unison and we're a great three musketeer quad, because I agree with both of you guys, 100 or 99. JoJo Diaz, who's sitting to the right of us, just looked up with his eyes really big and saying, wow. But regardless, Rene Alvarado improves to 24-7. So for the first time in the United States, he gets the victory. He's now 1-5 in the U.S.
Gets over the hump. Congratulations to
and
him.
Alvarado looks solid
in
this fight. Jason Velez?
Flat, listless. There needs to be some kind of change, either in his nutrition or, you know, maybe in the way he prepared for this fight. But he just didn't look like himself tonight. And, you know, maybe it was just a bad night at the office. That happens.
Or to be blunt, I'll be honest, he just might be an old 28. It happens.
That also happens in boxing.
Fighters age differently.
And the 10 rounds with Diaz Jr. and the 10 rounds against Ronnie Rios, those weren't light rounds. Those were hard rounds, took a lot of damage to his body.
Went up and he had trouble making the 130. Rene Alvarado, Managua, Nicaragua, improves it 24-7. Six fights on your card. Rashidi Ellis with the win. Cesar Diaz, 18-year-old pro debut from Palmdale, with a third round KO. Azat Hovhannissian put on a good show. KO in the fifth. He's now 9-2. Marco Magdaleno from Las Vegas, now living in Coachella, 4-0. And John Leon, Bogota, Colombia, in his pro debut, the 22-year-old, a first round KO. A great night of action. We'll be back here on Ring TV Live July 30th. Now, for everybody involved with the staff, the guys flying the drones, everybody with the recaps, for my partner, Doug Fisher,
Steve Kim, David Escott-Tatro, everybody inside the Golden Boy office, and for our president and founder, Oscar De La Hoya, I'm Beth the Duran saying thank you for watching. Good night. This has been another presentation of Ring TV Live.